All right, this is Vladimir today. This is the fifth day of studying the concept of leisure. Then I'm going to read the article "Embrace Price of Idleness" by Bertrand Russell, and probably read some other works if I'll have time. But actually, yeah, today I have a big plan. I mean, I guess I'm going to make this recording longer than I did in previous days, since I want to read the whole article, and it's 11 pages, and I've read only 2 pages, so it's gonna 3 pages. Yeah, it's like 8 pages. And besides, I have other materials which I'm gonna share, but I'm not sure whether or not I'll be able to talk about these materials. Probably I'll just read you articles without discussing them, since I guess there wouldn't be a lot of time. Anyway, let's start. So yesterday I stopped by reading this paragraph, and now I'm going to read it once again and start, making sense out of it. From the beginning of civilization until the Industrial Revolution, the man could, as a rule, produce by hard work little more than was required for the subsistence of himself and his family. Although his wife worked at least as hard as he did, and his children added their labor as soon as they were old enough to do so. Okay, from the beginning of civilization until the Industrial Revolution. So the whole idea is that Industrial Revolution brought some leisure, since before that, men and their wives and children had to work, most of them, but not everybody, I guess. Kings and the higher upper classes didn't work. Maybe they ruled, but it's like it's also kind of work. But still, there were, well, maybe priests also didn't work, but most of people had to work all the time, according to Bertrand Russell, of course. We may argue about it a lot. I guess there were lots of people who didn't work, who found their ways of parasiting on a social body or whatever. Anyway, so once again, from the beginning of civilization until the Industrial Revolution, everybody had to work. The small surplus above bare necessaries was not left to those who produced it, but was appropriated by warriors and priests. Yeah, again, like you have to work, and not you, but people had to work, and if they gained more than necessary for them for living, it was just taken from them by priests or warriors, basically by kings and organized religion. In times of famine, there was no surplus. The warriors and priests, however, still secured as much as at other times, with the result that many of the workers died of hunger. So when there was famine, when people starved to death, warriors and priests still had something to eat, since they, secured as much as at other times. The system persisted in Russia until 1917. I don't know why he cites Russia, but okay, let's go on. And still persists in the East and England in spite of the Industrial Revolution. Okay, I guess he, in this essay, and probably it was one of his earliest essays, since he definitely want to say that in Russia there was a certain change, and in other countries, there was no change. Yeah, I heard some story about Bertrand Russell visiting communist Russia, so in the Soviet Union, when it started. Yeah, and I guess I need to check out where this essay was written, just to understand it a little bit better. So, in the first of Idleness, Bertrand Russell, Wikipedia, another essay in 1935. Yeah, there was there was at that time in Russia, there was, I guess, huge progress. In the 20s, there were many problems. I don't know exactly the history of Soviet Union economy. I remember from classes of history that there were some problems, famine, and but they were solved, and in mid-30s it was much better, but still we're preparing for war. And I don't know, okay, I didn't want to talk about it. I don't know why I'm engaging in this discussion. Anyway, so in Russia, persisted in Russia until 1970. So what kind of system? System where priests and workers take the surplus from workers and from peasants and from the other part of society, and still persists in the East. In England, in spite of the Industrial Revolution, it remained in full force throughout the Napoleonic Wars and until 100 years ago, when the new class of manufacturers acquired power. Oh, okay, it's like in Russia, it stopped at 1917. In East, it's still there. So basically kings and priests rule the social structure, social organizations, society in general. And in England, it stopped 100 years ago, and here first of the time, like 1830. All right, when the class of manufacturers acquired power, so basically when bourgeoisie became like the real power in English societies, in England. It talks about England. Is it true? Yeah, I'm not familiar with I didn't read almost anything related to English history in these times, though I know this period, like 1930s, there was wars in Russia, for example. There was attack on Poland, and like Russian Tsar Nikolai the First became very unpopular in Europe, since he took some Polish lands, and in Polish there was a revolution, and he basically attacked those people who tried to liberate Poland, and he took some lands, and then he became a. It's almost like almost the same. It's not the same, but it looks almost like what happened in 2014. Although again, I'm not so familiar with that. I'm not going to comment too much. Anyway, so the whole idea is that in England, 1830, in Russia, 1917, and in East, it's still there. Kings and priests rule. Again, it's like I'm just commenting on the essay. I'm not sure whether or not it was the case. I'm trying to figure that out. And my goal here is to understand how Bertrand Russell thinks and what are his beliefs, what he wants to prove, how he views the world. Now, in America, the system came to an end with the revolution, except in the South. So revolution is even earlier than in England. American Revolution happened in 1776. And therefore, it's like 200 years from this time, 170 years ago. So 100 years ago, 170 years ago, except in the South, where it persisted until the Civil War. In the South, it was lasting a little longer. Okay, a system which lasted so long and ended so recently has naturally left a profound impress upon men's thoughts and opinions. Okay, and like all literature, not all literature, but a lot of things which have been written and believed stemmed from this social structure, social order. Much that we take for granted about the desirability of work is derived from this system. Desirability of work is derived from this system. And being pre-industrial is not adapted to the modern world. So, okay, like this system where there was a king and, you know, aristocracy, intellectual aristocracy in, you know, like priests and maybe some scholars who basically was writing and teaching according to the king. So the king and the monarchy itself basically dictated everything that was written, and there was severe punishments. So now people complain that if you're in Russia, if you say something against like Putin, or if you say something against government, you will have some problems. And you know, you go on the internet and everybody like mocks Putin, and not everybody, of course, but you know, for example, such figures which now I don't want to mention anybody, but the whole idea is that lots of people talk about, you know, regime and Tsar, and they may say whatever they want, and not everybody gets in trouble. Of course, some people get in trouble, but not everybody. And it's like if you say, for example, I'm gonna say now that I don't like Putin, right? Or I'm gonna say now that I don't like the modern like whatever regime was going on here. I'm not saying that, but I may say that. And if I say that, I probably won't get in trouble if I just explain my own personal views and say, you know, there's a corrupt system, whatever. And if you said that back then, in these times, like 200 years ago, for example, when there was Nikolai III in Russia, so if you just write something, no, I don't agree with the system, that's the end of your life, basically. Not your life, but nobody is going to give you the platform for publishing your works. Nobody is going to, you know, support you. And if governments know, will know that you said something against it, anything, just maybe slander, maybe some critique, whatever, you'll just immediately get in serious troubles. Whereas now, again, it's mild, relatively to what was going on back in the days. By the way, I'm talking, of course, I've read the collected works of Kherson, I've read the collected works of Slutkov-Shchedrin, I've read almost everything written by Belinsky, Dobrolyubov, like three volumes of Dobrolyubov, 2,000 pages, five or six volumes of Belinsky, three volumes of Kisev. So it's like, I know what was going on. And I read classical literature, and I read some, you know, philosophical, historical analysis, like Bechernyshevsky, whoever, Lenin. Yeah, it's what's going on now. It's like we are living in a paradise, if we compare it, like paradise for, you know, for free thinkers, for free speech, whatever. It's like it's you just have to have certain power to say something. Of course, if you just complain about something without any reason, you may again get in trouble. And if you persist, especially, but if you explain what you think, if you're rational, if you may defend your criticism, no problem, you say whatever you like to say. Okay, anyway, let's go forward. Much that we take for granted about the desirability of work is derived from this system. So basically, I guess later he's going to tell us that, you know, these people who were, as Veblen calls them, the leisure class. So these people will basically dictate the social order, and they will force, they were forcing other people to believe that work is something divine, and you have to work, otherwise you are just a parasite. And you know, that was the case for that time, and it's still the case now. I mean, work became a virtue, and Bertrand Russell wants to argue that it wasn't always the case, and maybe it's not good. Maybe it's good for a certain group of people, but it's not good for everybody. Probably it's not good for an individual. It's good for society. Maybe, yeah. We can't argue that on a social level we improved our life tremendously. Like what was going on 100 years ago, 200 years ago, compared to what's going on right now, Well, at least in terms of, you know, comfort, in terms of opportunities for any individual, just, you know, become somebody, in terms of social relations, like a huge, like huge progress. But of course, you can say that it's an individual level, there's a huge progress. And another people became, you know, more shallow. Well, I don't, it's also not the truth, since when we find lots of cases where there's great philosophers living right now, thinking, you know, writing great books, analyzing history, the world, studying science, whatever. And yeah, just my perception, but still there was, you know, as my problem is just my view, since I was reading lots of literature about, you know, written in 19th century, 18th century, like 17th century, 16th century, 15th century, nation times. And I read a little bit about what's going on nowadays and some, not modern, but no, I don't read modern books. I don't read almost anything which is written now, since for me, I have my own eyes and I have my own mind to judge what's going on. So I didn't need some modern philosophers telling me what's going on in the world. I might tell you it on my own, but what was going on before, yeah, that's what was interesting for me for many years, and I studied it carefully and thoroughly. And I compare it with what's going on now, and I may tell that, at least in my opinion, what I see when I compare it to what was going on 200 years ago, 100 years ago, I would prefer to live in this world instead of living in that. And of course, we can't argue about technology. So then, at that time, there was no technology. There's no internet, there's no TV, radio, you know, connections, phones, communications, whatever. Not only these technologies, but also, you know, there was no houses, like big houses. I guess the highest house was like 5 floors or whatever. Now we have skyscrapers and in cities and towns, and they grew. There was no cities. Like the city where I live right now, like it has 500,000 people. So the population of the city is 500,000 people. And I guess if we place, like take the whole city, which is right now here, and place it, for example, in 17th century somewhere, I know, like the whole city with its infrastructure and everything was going on here. Like this city immediately become the capital of the world, since all its technologies, all its, you know, it's just miracles. And that's an interesting idea to think about, like, you know, placing modern cities in a, you know, it's an idea for a science fiction writer, or for some writer who writes novel, just to take the whole city, the modern city, like, you know, Paris, Moscow, Washington, Berlin, and just place it in the middle ages, or even Greece time, and see how the city may, you know, transform the whole population of humans on Earth. Well, I'll probably write such a novel, but you know, I have no time for writing novel. But it's fine, you know, I'm discussing. There's so many amazing ideas coming when you just think and read books. Anyway, let's go on. So it's not adapted to the modern world. So what he wants to say is that this cultural mindset, which was developed in these ideas about leisure and work, which grew on the body of, you know, social tissue. No, on the body, social tissue doesn't sound well. Anyway, so this whole system of beliefs and ideologies, which were developed in pre-industrial era, they are not relevant to what was going on in Bertrand Russell's times. So it's modern world inherited lots of prejudices and superstitions, which had to be taken away somehow. Modern technique has made it possible for leisure within limits to be not the prerogative, pejorative. Yes, they aren't like pejorative. They are also like pejorative. Like this word pejorative. Well, it looks like prerogative. Prerogative, is it the correct way of saying that? I'm not sure. I haven't heard this word. I know what it means, but I don't know how to pronounce it.
Prerogative.
Okay, not prerogative. Prerogative. All right, prerogative. To be not the prerogative of small privileged classes, but the right to be evenly distributed throughout the community. The morality of work is the morality of slaves, and the modern world has no need of slavery. Okay, modern, like this is the sentence. So modern technique has made it possible for leisure with limits, not only for kings and priests, but for lots of people. Yeah, and it may be distributed evenly throughout the community, as Bertrand Russell thinks. So the morality of work is the morality of slaves, and the modern world has no need of slavery. So he wants to argue that work is no longer necessary. And like these relationships, when one people do certain labor and other people tell them how to do this labor, it was outdated already, like in 1935, when he was writing his essay. Okay, let's go on and see how he will defend his arguments, his views. It is obvious that in primitive communities, peasants left to themselves would not have parted with the slender surplus upon which the warriors and priests subsisted, but would have either produced less or consumed more. At first, sheer force compelled them to produce in part with the surplus. Gradually, however, it was found possible to induce many of them to accept an ethic according to which it was their duty to work hard, although part of their work went to support others in idleness. By this means, the amount of compulsion required was lessened, and the expenses of government were diminished. To this day, 99% of British wage earners would be genuinely shocked if it were proposed that the king should not have a larger income than a working man. The conception of duty, speaking historically, has been a means used by the holders of power to induce others to live for the interests of their masters rather than for their own. Of course, the holders of power conceal this fact from themselves by managing to believe that their interests are identical with the larger interests of humanity. Sometimes this is true. Ethnic slave owners, for instance, employed part of their leisure in making a permanent contribution to civilization, which would have been impossible under a just economic system. Leisure is essential to civilization. In former times, leisure for the few was only rendered possible by the labors of the many. But their labors were valuable, not because work is good, but because leisure is good. And with modern technique, it would be possible to distribute leisure justly without injury to civilization. All right. Yeah, I guess if I'm going to continue considering this, following paragraph in the same way as I did the first one, it's going to take me too much time. But yeah, why not? Like, I mean, who cares? The problem is today is Friday, and tomorrow I have a discussion about leisure. And day after tomorrow, I can continue this work even after the discussion. But the next Monday, I have to start working on the next topic. Next topic, now I think we are going to take modesty, since I see some connections between leisure and modesty, and I also was thinking about it throughout this week. I was in the shopping gallery a little bit, and here reminded me this like idea of modesty. And I have, you know, certainly I have different views related to modesty. And most of these views, like most of what I think about modesty is determined by, you know, Schopenhauer, and like, I guess he made a certain impact on me and made me believe that modesty isn't good. And I'm not a modest man. I mean, and I think that modesty, the problem with modesty is that it's it contradicts honesty. So if you think about, like, if you want to be honest, you can be modest. Yes, it can be at some moments, of course, but, you know, whether there is a contradiction between modesty and honesty. So I tend to, you know, follow these instincts dictated by honesty instead of modesty. So sometimes I may praise myself, but sometimes I may praise myself. No, sometimes it may look as if I'm praising myself, but it's just, you know, me being honest, talking about what I think and how I, you know, what I'm doing. And, you know, since I'm studying, like, you know, I always emphasize that I read certain books, I, you know, do certain work. And for an average man, it sounds like I'm always showing off. But it's not showing off. It's just me describing what I'm doing. I'm studying for 12 years, like even more, for 13 years, since 2008, even more, since 2007. Like 2007, I started studying with myself and gradually, like, different sciences. And since 2011, I'm on this path. So I spent all my time studying myself, philosophy, literature, poetry, science. And when I'm speaking about my actions, it's not showing off. It's just the way how I live. I'm talking about myself, what I'm doing, why I'm doing that, trying to explain it. If I talk to somebody else, or trying to understand it if I just talk to myself. And I understand that for many people, like, it's unbearable to communicate with me, since I'm always like talking like that. And I see that the only way is just to get rid of all communications. But, you know, when it's necessary, for example, I read the speaking club, I come to the club once a week, and I may just pretend that I'm a different person, or, you know, try to play fair and not be too whatever. But most of the time, I just try to stay away from communication, since whenever I just start talking, it looks as if I'm trying to show off, I'm trying to suppress somebody else, or I'm trying to make something, to put somebody else down. But it's not true. I'm just trying to tell about my perception of the world, about what I'm doing, why I'm doing that, and sometimes persuade other people to do the same, sometimes, you know, criticize them for wasting their time. But usually I prefer to avoid any communications in relationships. Like, unless they really based on common interests, like in literature and poetry and philosophy and studying languages, etc. So, as I said, I think I don't want to consider every sentence, since I don't have enough time. I may do that, but it's going to take me like three or four hours to read this short essay in this way, and then I won't be able to finish like my project of studying later. I want to finish it faster, and I also have some other books and articles which I want to read today. So I guess if there's something that I really want to discuss, I'll just make a pause and think about it. Otherwise, I'm just going to read the essay without, you know, without stopping. This is kind of obvious. So whatever here or here, it was, I could understand that there's no need to get through each sentence and try to make sense of every sentence and every word. Okay, modern technique has made it possible to diminish enormously the amount of labor required to secure the necessities of life for everyone. This was made obvious during the war. At that time, all the men in the armed forces, and all the men and women engaged in the production of munitions, all the men and women engaged in spying, war propaganda, or government offices connected with the war, were withdrawn from productive occupations. In spite of this, the general level of well-being among unskilled wage earners on the side of the Allies was higher than before or since. The significance of this fact was concealed by finance. Borrowing made it appear as if the future was nourishing the present. But that, of course, would have been impossible. A man cannot eat a loaf of bread and does not yet exist. The war showed conclusively that by the scientific organization of production, it is possible to keep modern populations in fair comfort on a small part of the working capacity of the modern world. If at the end of the war, the scientific organization, which had been created in order to liberate men for fighting in the munition war, had been preserved, at the hours of the week had been cut down to four, and the hours of the week had been cut down to four, all would have been well. Instead of that, the old chaos was restored. Those whose work was demanding were made to work long hours, and the rest were left to starve, strafe as unemployed. Starve, strafe, starve, starvation. No, starve.
Starve.
What did I read as strafe? Starve, okay. To left to starve as unemployed. Why? Because work is a duty, and a man should not receive wages in proportion to what he has produced, but in proportion to his virtues exemplified by his industry. All right, so I have this idea, and let's make a short comment. 2012, I wrote an article which was called The Thoughts on Work. Yeah, it's like in Russian it was «Размышления о работе». And in this article, I basically was saying that, again, I wrote it because I had arguments with my peers and with people whom I communicated at that time quite often. And I said that, you know, you don't need to work for 8 hours. And we as a society don't need to work for 8 hours. We may actually reduce it to three hours. But it wasn't like my argument wasn't that. My argument was like, you know, everybody has to work as much as they want, as much as they need, not like 8 hours or, you know, if I may earn enough money for 5 hours a week and provide everything necessary for my life, I don't need to work 40 hours a week. But the whole idea is like, yeah, I was writing about, I can't remember exactly, to be honest. Like my argument was also that, you know, people who, like it's hard to communicate with people. It's almost impossible to tell people that, you know, to make them believe that work, like that it's not necessary to work 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. And it's almost the same as arguing with them about playing, about watching some TV or whatever. So you just, it's almost impossible. Okay, it seems I can't explain it. But the whole idea that it wasn't an argumentative essay, which I wrote. It was basically a caricature and some kind of mockery. So I was making fun. And in this essay, I basically said something bizarre, but I said it in a way, it's like, it wasn't like, this is what I think, and this is like three propositions why I think that, and here's the conclusion. No, it was like, ha ha ha, what's going on? See, it's stupid. Let's think about why it's stupid. It's stupid because people are stupid. And this was my, you know, view which I held back then. Now I don't think that way anymore. But well, I think kind of different. Maybe a little bit different. I don't know. So the idea, once again, was that to reduce work to 3 hours, and we still may live generally And it is going to be enough for us, and especially like with the rise of this internet, social networks, and artificial intelligence, whatever. There was robots, more and more robots, more and more machinery, and all this labor was basically substituted, like human labor was substituted with manual labor, like with machine labor. And yeah, and the whole idea that we still must work, like everybody must work too much. But I was basically arguing about leisure. And exactly this was the whole idea that instead of working, you have to, you have to learn, not you have to learn, but I don't want to work. I want to have leisure as much as possible. I want to dedicate this leisure to studying philosophy, arts and sciences and doing stuff which I really like to do. And everybody will do the same, but people are, oh, I need to buy lots of things. I need to buy a car. I need to buy an expensive cloth. I need to buy an expensive food. I need to buy certain things which are necessary. And there's like, I need to earn 50,000 rubles. My argument was that you don't need 50,000 rubles, or 20,000 rubles back then. You need just 5,000 rubles a month, and you will live decently and do meaningful things, like again, studying, writing, reading. Yeah. And well, it didn't work. I mean, it wasn't like, since that, I didn't find anybody who actually could understand me. I mean, I was talking to many people. And for most of my acquaintances and friends, this argument was detrimental. I mean, I stopped my relationships with many people because they couldn't understand what I was talking about. And I saw no value in communicating with them since, just I had a lot of leisure and I invested this leisure in basically in education, and not just self-education, but try to educate others as well. But they like had no leisure and preferred to work. And it's like, it wasn't only like that, but like if they had to work to fulfill their basic needs, that's okay. I don't argue with that. But most of them, they were just liars. So they were telling things like, I have to earn like 30,000 rubles, 50,000 rubles. But most of them earned this money and they saved. That's the whole idea. It's like saving. Come on. They saved. They had like millions in their savings and still continued working. And I was arguing that, the best budget, like, you have to keep it on zero. So this is the whole idea. Right? It's like you may be alive only if you have no, like the rest money you have, like to go down. I mean, when you lend money, it's not good. So if your budget is below zero, sub-zero. So if you are dependent on somebody, it's not good. And if you have money, it's also not good. So the whole idea is like to stay close to zero. And I guess it was the source of my nihilism as well. So it's like, if you don't have money, but you have everything you need, this is the perfect state. And if you have money, some savings, it makes like basically corrupts your soul, if you will. And if you have to borrow money from somebody else, it's even worse. So of course, like the perfect state is when you have zero. So when, for example, you earn 5,000 rubles a month, and you spend 5,000 rubles a month. This is perfect. So you don't need to save, you just need to work. And you don't need to care about future, about pension. Since you invest, like you earn 5,000 rubles a month, not for the whole month. You earn it for 3-4 days. And then you spend 25 days reading philosophy. You see, and then you don't need 5 years of that life, and you'll grow to the level where nobody is going to, you'll be independent completely. You don't need money at all. So you may organize some stupid activity, get this damn 5,000 rubles or, 100 bucks a month, or, as much as you need. And then do whatever you like to pursue your projects, to pursue your personal happiness. Yeah, but again, it's hard to argue with people, especially in foreign language. Let's go on. I wanted just to say that this paragraph appeals to me since I was writing almost exactly the same thing, but of course to like differently, a little differently, more stupidly. Yeah, but it was 9 years ago, 2012. That's fine. Okay, and I haven't tried this. Now I'm reading this one. I can understand better what I was writing. And I can understand, of course, this since it's like a part of my experience. And this was written in 1935. So Bertrand Russell understood what I understood at 2011 or 2012, like 8 years, 8 years before. That he probably was a grower guy. Yeah, by the way, I want to say a few words about Bertrand Russell. First of all, I read one of his books, The Principles of Mathematics, at the end of 2019. And this was a book which made me kind of, you know, I got another cognitive overdose after reading the book. It was a long book, like 400 pages, and it was incomprehensible. I mean, The Principles of Mathematics, I have some, you know, I have some knowledge in math, not so well. Like, I tried to study math on my own, and I probably invested like probably a few hundred hours since 2013 in studying math. So, but I couldn't understand anything in this book, but I still read it just for fun. It was fun, I mean, reading the whole book, 400 pages, and just, well, I could understand, of course, something, but the logic, his ideas, how he formulated them, how he expressed them. I didn't read the book like I'm reading this book, obviously. I was reading it fast, so I started reading, read like 20 pages an hour or something, and I've read this book maybe in a week or a little bit longer. And after that, for a month, I didn't read anything. I didn't even write since I had lots of noise, since I downloaded basically so much stuff which I couldn't understand in my brain, had to digest all of this. And yeah, it was hard. I mean, but it was funny, and I enjoyed it. And I developed kind of appreciation to Bertrand Russell's intelligence and how he thought, even though like most of it's like it's not that I take everything seriously, what Bertrand Russell wrote, and trust him any word he says. No, but it's like, oh, this was like the guy who understood what he was talking about, and he was really passionate about studying, learning. He knew what he was doing, and I probably may listen to him at some moments, but usually it's like, you know, most of it I would know just the bit. I'm reading this book not to learn something new that I didn't know, but, you know, just to see how other people think and probably improve my language, since I need to develop my English, and I'm not satisfied with the way how I speak, and I see that there's like I need to enlarge my vocabulary, even though it consists now of, like, I mean, it's huge, but it's not enough, and I want to improve it, and that's why I'm reading, like, to borrow some expressions which help me to understand better what I'm talking about as well and thinking. Anyway, so this is the morality of slave state, applied in circumstances totally unlike those in which it arose. No wonder the result has been disastrous. Let us take an illustration. Suppose that at a given moment, a certain number of people are engaged in the manufacture of pins. They make as many pins. What is a pin, by the way? Pin for joining. For joining. Fastening a short thin piece of metal with a sharp point on one end, especially for fastening together pieces of cloth. Oh, okay, I got it. While making clothes. Yeah, I got it. Pin. Yeah, it's like this thing. This is a pin. Decoration, electrical, bone, part of bone, gold. All right. So they make as many pins as the world needs, working 8 hours a day. Someone makes an invention by which the same number of men can make twice as many pins. Pins are already so cheap that hardly any more will be bought at a lower price. In a sensible world, everybody concerned in the manufacturing of pins would take to working 4 hours instead of 8. And everything else would go on as before. But in the actual world, this would be thought demoralizing. The men still work 8 hours. There are too many pins. Some employers go bankrupt, and half the men previously concerned in making pins are thrown out of work. There is, in the end, just as much leisure as one on the other plane. But half the men are totally idle, while half are still overworked. This way, it is ensured that the unavoidable leisure shall cause misery all around instead of being the universal source of happiness. Can anything more insane be imagined? All right, so I deal with pins. I like this example. So probably if I, you know, was studying at university or if I prepared this for some, if I had to give an account to somebody else about my studies, I'll probably take this example, memorize it, and then tell it to show how smart I am, how much I can remember. But no, yeah, I understand that there's no need to memorize it. The idea that the poor should have leisure has always been shocking to the rich. In England, in the early 19th century, 15 hours was the ordinary day's work for a man. In the early 19th century, 15 hours. In England, it's like it's in the most developed country at that moment, in one of the most developed countries at that moment, 15 hours. 15, it's like, you know, you have 1 hour to eat and to work from home to the factory. Another 15 hours you are doing work and you are put there, not by, like, well, you get some wage, of course, you earn some money necessary for you to feed your family, but basically you are put there not by, you know, this, you are put there by power. So if you don't go there, you'll basically be, you know, not by power, because there's social economic force anyway. So I think I said something stupid, but who cares? All right, children sometimes did as much and very commonly did 12 hours a day. When Middleton, busybody suggested that perhaps these hours were rather long, they were told that work kept adults from drink and children from mischief. When I was a child, shortly after urban working men had acquired the vote, certain public holidays were established by law to the great indignation of the upper classes. Indignation, yeah. It's like public holidays were established by law, and upper classes were upset since, you know, everybody must work except me. All right. I remember hearing an old douche say, what do the poor want with holidays? They ought to work. People nowadays are less frank, but the sentiment persists and is the source of much of our economic confusion. All right, so here, this example, how hard it was for people to work, how many hours they worked 100 years ago in England, and they didn't work because, you know, it was necessary for them, but because it was necessary for upper class to buy, you know, castles and jewelry and all sorts of luxury. And they still believed that they had to work because they were decent men, and this was like an ideology. Yeah, it's like now I see it way deeper, like what was doing these social democratists in Russia in the 19th century. It's like basically there's 90% of population who starve to death and have to work. Like I'm talking about the end of the 19th century, not about the time when there was still slavery or serfdom. So they had to work, they earn nothing. And there's like 10% of people who realize, like, what they're talking now, that, oh, now in the world, there's like 10% or 1% of people who have more money than the rest of the population. But sure, but how, should I work? I mean, now I don't need to work and I don't care. I'm basically free. But then if you, like me, if you say, like, you know, I'm a peasant, let's suppose that, or, you know, some from, what was the social classes anyway? So I'm a peasant, and I say, look, I'm not going to work. I, you know, I have my tree with apples. I have some potatoes field, and that's enough for me to, yeah, it's like I'm an independent peasant. Let's say, just got my freedom in 1862 or whatever, and don't need to pay anybody. Maybe some, you know, some aristocrats for their land in the future, 49 years, I guess, was the problem, 49 years. That's crazy. Anyway, so I have to work, but I would say, I don't want to work, I'm going to, you know, study literature. I'm a peasant who wants to study literature, to read Leo Tolstoy's books, and, you know, maybe some culture do it. Or maybe study a foreign language and read Balzac, or who else was writing there? Stendhal. Or even Hegel or Feuerbach. No, in Russia, for example, it was, you know, if you mention Feuerbach in the middle of 19th century, it's like, you're done. It's like, you don't need to tell me. Talking about the government, right? So, and about censorship, about saying something against the government. So if you mention in Russia, when it was like the case for Belinsky, for Herzen, for Dobrolubov, for Pisarev, Dobrolubov actually was making fun of some other writer, I remember, about mentioning Feuerbach, but he didn't mention Feuerbach, he didn't say his name, but make a reference to him by, you know, some the other name, called him as it was, but he used this slam, which was understood by a certain group of people, and Dobrolubov was making fun of this man, just, yeah, it was actually, No. Now I remember it more clearly. So it was Oblomov and Dobrolubov. I'm not sure exactly, but it seems it was Oblomov who was talking about Feuerbach, and Dobrolubov was making fun and of this character, trying, like, asking, like, what this guy might tell about Feuerbach. Let's listen to him. His stupid judgments on Feuerbach. But the whole idea, like, in like after, I guess, in the end of 1850s, you can't mention Feuerbach. If you mention Feuerbach in your writing, you'll go to, you know, Fuitas, something called Shigin called it. So you'll be sent to Siberia immediately, just for mentioning one name. Or if you say something like socialist, or, you know, at that time there were Fourierist, like followers of Charles Fourier, and nihilists, it's like it was Saltykov-Shchedrin, he mentioned, I've read 10 volumes of Saltykov-Shchedrin, and I didn't find the word nihilist in his books, only in comments, but it made 100 years later. But the word nihilist was so forbidden, like after this whole, you know, there were some social changes, but yeah, there were some problems. And Turgenev used this word, I guess, the first time in Fathers and Sons, and then there was what happened there. And you know, yeah, Saltykov-Shchedrin was writing later. It was about, like, there was a king killed, Alexander III, by bomb. And Dostoevsky described these events in the book called Demons. Yeah, not the event, but, you know, he tried to put it, like how this, conspiracy theories were formed in Russia. Basically, this book is Demons is about that. And what was there? What I wanted to say? Yeah, the king was killed, and after that, there was like a strong reaction. And basically, you couldn't publish anything, couldn't say anything. But anyway, so the idea poor should get leave us. Yeah, it's like if you are rich, you don't want poor to have leisure. You want poor to work. That's what makes them poor. That's basically this mindset and slave morality, or what was originally. Yeah, this is the morality of the slave state. So morality where rich don't work, but they force poor to work. They don't, this is an ideology. I mean, and all poor believe that it's good to work. And as soon as you end, the problem is that, you know, rich understand that, the rich understand that working, there may be some good work, but they understand that work is not like leisure. This is the purpose. And you can, like, if you're poor, you may talk about with the rich. But if you talk with the poor about work, if you say there's an ideology which basically, like, if I'm working 8 hours, let's suppose I'm working 8 hours every day for 5 days a week. And now there's another person, and he comes to me and says something like, you know, I work 3 hours a week, and it's enough for me to fulfill my basic needs, and all the other time I spent like at my leisure. And you know, if you work 40 hours a week, you may get upset basically. This man, he is just a lazy man, he doesn't do anything, he is a parasite. And I am like a decent individual who works, like who contributes to the society, he makes society grow. And this man, he is just a piece of shit. And that's basically the treatment which I got for 12 years, for 13 years, from almost everybody. I mean, I'm not talking about everybody, but 90% of people with whom I communicated, like, you know, short communication, short talks, like acquaintances, they all believe that. They believe that, you know, if you work, you're a good person. If you don't work, you're a bad person. And no matter how you argue with them, no matter what you are going to say about education, intellectual work, it doesn't work. But if you give them the book to read, to, like, you know, to help them understand what's going on, it doesn't work as well. That's the state of affairs. But I'm not upset about that, by the way. Yeah, now I was upset. No, you may read my journals if you know Russian language. So I published all my journals here. And it was like these 12 years. And you may go here, Prozor.ru, and there's 1,2900 papers. Like, it basically is like one. So this is just pages of my journal. So you go there, and you just read one, another. And these pages, they are actually from my real journals. So I have journals, like, you know, just a part, like I have 10, now, by now I have like 10 journals. And I just published them all on the internet. And from the beginning, without hiding anything, like all my stupidity, everything there, like all my, I didn't even, the first time when I published my journal, I didn't even correct mistakes. So if you're in Russian, go there and just see what was going on, what I'm talking about. And I stopped publishing it at the end of thousands. Like, I published it, I stopped publishing it recently in February, but the time there is just the end of 2016. Since 2016, I shifted to English. I started writing in English, and I left half a year unpublished. I still have my journal. I'm going to make a book out of it later. Now I don't have enough time for that. And so, in like these 8 years from 2008, these like 1,000 notes, it's basically my daily writings about this period. So I started writing in 2008 in April, and I stopped writing in Russian. Well, these journals are finished at 2016 in August. And what I basically was doing these times, I was studying language, I was studying philosophy, I was studying literature, not just Russian literature, but, you know, not just Russian philosophy. I was studying German philosophy, Asian philosophy, cultures, literature, languages, not just English and and Russian, but also I studied Latin language, Greek language, Chinese. And I didn't, you know, not nowadays what we call philosophy, there's very little of philosophy. There are lots of professors of philosophy who basically explain you what other philosophers wrote. And what do? They take like Aristotle, they read the Nicomachean Ethic or, you know, whatever other books, and they make short articles writing about Aristotelian books or, you know, Plato's books or about Kant's books or about Schopenhauer, Hegel, whoever, Fichte, Wittgenstein, Bertrand Russell. So they write books about books, and they almost write nothing about themselves and about their experience. So what I was writing, I didn't, like, for the first, I guess, 4 years, I didn't even analyze books. So I was writing them basically in my journal. There was a note that I wrote 200 pages of some book, and no word about what I read, 200 pages of some book, and no word about what exactly I read there, and like all my experience, what I was doing, how it was changing my life, and every book, like, there was changes all the time. So since 2008, up to this moment, it's like my life is, there's no circles in my life. There's some circles, but most of the time just a straight line. So I'm just growing. And every month, every week, almost every day, I experience new thoughts, new ideas. I reread my journals. I reread my old journals. I reshape my understanding of my personal history. And of course, I read just, you know, books after books after books. And it's like, you know, it's never ending. And I see new meanings everywhere, like new ideas. It's so fascinating. I mean, I can't stop, and it makes me feel so amazing. Like most of the time when I'm healthy, sometimes I might be sick, and that time I may complain, like, in my mind. But in my journals, even when I'm sick, there's, you wouldn't find complaint, since, you know, I started my literature career from Carlos Castaneda. I've read Carlos Castaneda's books, and one of the ideas which stuck to my mind after reading his books was no excuses, no complaining. And I tried to, I wouldn't say that now that I made it perfect, I reached the perfect level, I still have lots of complaints. But this idea that to be perfect, you just shouldn't complain at all. So whatever is going on, just learn to understand it, learn to describe it clearly, and then you'll grow. You'll get to the point where what you experience, if it's painful, it will not be, you know, lasting long. As soon as you understand something, you go further, and complaining, as soon as you start complaining, you basically stuck. There is no way to get out of it. But if you don't complain, if you try to understand, you understand everything, just the nature, you know, the subconscious forces will lead you up or high, well. Okay, I was talking too much about myself. Now it's time to get back and read the dumb article, or I'll never finish it. Work, yeah, they are to work. People nowadays are less frank. Okay, I've read this paragraph. Yeah, once again, the whole idea is that upper classes and lower classes have different understanding of leisure and work. And sometimes the the opposite understanding, and like rich belief in something, like beliefs of rich, like rich belief in one thing and made the poor belief in exactly the opposite. And poor, of course, they don't form their opinions, they don't form their like views, they don't think for themselves. Since as soon as you start thinking, you get to this rich class immediately, even if you just, you know, being rich doesn't mean that you have $1 million and an expensive car and live in a great apartment. No, being rich, it means that you don't work, you have enough leisure. So if you have 10 hours for yourself every day, you are richer than Elon Musk. Elon Musk is a poor guy, by the way, since he's like busy all the time. He likes what he's doing, but I'm not sure that he understands what he is doing. And I'm not sure that he has like real leisure. And once again, like this, like, from a philosophical view, Elon Musk is a poor guy. he's not rich. And Bill Gates probably is also a poor guy. Everybody who has to work all the time is a poor guy. It's not rich. Rich is somebody who doesn't work. It's like an artist or a philosopher or, you know. But yeah, Bruma argued about it and said, what are you trying to reverse of me? It makes no sense. You're a philosopher yourself and you protect this, your worldview. You try to impose this worldview on everybody else. And it's not the idea of rich and poor. You're, you know, making black out of white. Yeah, maybe. I may do that. I don't know. But I'm trying to be honest. I'm trying to be authentic. I'm trying to think aloud and read the book and understand what's going on there and explain what I read through, applying it to my personal experience, to what I see, to what I do, and to my observations of what's going on around and inside as well. All right, let us for a moment consider the ethics of work friendly, without superstition. Every human being of necessity consumes in the course of his life a certain amount of the produce of human labor. Assuming, as we may, that labor is on the whole disagreeable, it is unjust that a man should consume more than he produces. Of course, he may provide services rather than commodities, like a medical man, for example, but he should provide something in return for his board and lodging. To this extent, the duty of work must be admitted, but to this extent only. All right, equality. I shall not dwell upon the fact that in all modern societies outside the USSR, many people escape even this minimum amount of work, namely all those who inherit money and all those who marry money. I do not think the fact that these people are allowed to be idle is nearly so harmful as the fact that wage earners are expected to overwork or starve. If the ordinary wage earner worked 4 hours a day, there would be enough for everybody and no unemployment. Assuming a certain very moderate amount of sensible organization. This idea shocks the well-to-do because they are convinced that the poor would not know how to use so much leisure. An American man often work long hours even when they are well off. Such men naturally are indignant at the idea of leisure for wage earners, except as the grim punishment of unemployment. In fact, they dislike leisure even for their sons. Oddly enough, while they wish their sons to work so hard as to have no time to be civilized, they do not mind their wives and daughters having no work at all. The snobbish admiration of uselessness, which in an aristocratic society extends to both sexes, is under a plutocracy confined to women. This, however, does not make it any more in agreement with common sense. All right, you know, 4 hours labor day, there will be unemployment, but people, most people are brainwashed and they believe that if there's no work, people get mad or get bored, they don't know what to do, they start drinking, they start doing some stupid things, and basically it injures the whole society, social structure. So everybody must work. It's like, you know, if you don't go to school when you're a child, you do all crazy things. Therefore, you have to go to school to be educated instead of, you know, living a normal child life, playing games and basically enjoying existence. Yeah, that's crazy, man. All right. The wise use of leisure, it must be considered, is a product of civilization education. A man who has worked 1 hour all his life will become bored if he becomes suddenly idle. But without a considerable amount of leisure, man is cut off from many of the best things. There is no longer any reason why the bulk of the population should suffer this deprivation. Only a foolish asceticism, usually vicarious, it's not clear pronunciation of the word. I guess it's vicarious, but vicarious. Usually vicarious makes us continue to insist on work in excessive quantities now that the need no longer exists. Okay. He basically advocates that leisure is all about studying philosophy and science, and it's not laying on the beach and jerking off. All right, in the new creed, which controls the government of Russia, while there's much that is very different from the traditional teaching of the West, there are some things that are quite unchanged. The attitude of the governing classes, and especially of those who conduct educational propaganda on the subject of the dignity of labor, is almost exactly that which the governing classes of the world have always preached to what were called the honest poor. Industry, sobriety, willingness to work long hours for distant advantages, even submissiveness to authority, all these reappear. Moreover, authority still represents the will of the ruler of the universe, who, however, is now called by a new name, dialectical materialism. I like this sentence. Dialectical materialism. Replaced God, by the way. Just again, Bertrand Russell makes fun out of USSR. That's cool. Yeah, I enjoy this reading, though it's like, you know, I'm not saying, like, one way of making fun is just harsh mocking, and another way of making fun is just saying something subtle and something that people can understand. And people who understand what, like, for example, dialectical materialism, I don't think that there but there are 100 people in Russia who can understand what it means. And even now, since I watched a few lectures by a professor, I guess his name was Popov, and I watched his lectures at the end of 2016, exactly at the time when I shifted to the English language. Yeah, if I'm not wrong, but it seems like it was exactly this time, or no, or yes, or it was 2015, in the beginning. Anyway, it was 2016. I watched these lectures by Pope, but he is a professor at St. Petersburg University, and lectures was exactly about dialectical materialism. And I started listening, and I watched maybe the first lecture. I enjoyed it since it was just kind of preface, and he outlined what he is going to talk about. And I was curious about dialectical materialism since I read lots of Lenin, Marx, whatever. And the first lecture, I was excited. But since the second, when he started talking about, when he started really talking what he understood by dialectical materialism, I was disappointed immediately. And I probably watched a few more lectures, hoping that I'll find something meaningful, but I didn't find anything. I realized that even like on this level now, so there's like professors in university who teach dialectical materialism, and their understanding is so vague and so prejudiced and so naive that, as I said, there's probably no, I wouldn't say that I understand it clearly, but I definitely dedicated a lot of time studying it, as well as studying idealism, like studying Hegel. And by studying, I mean like what I'm doing right now. So it's like reading books, enjoying it, thinking about it, trying to make sense, and writing, applying my personal experience to everything that I read, and looking how it influences my thinking, my understanding, my worldview. Yeah, and dialectical materialism is like, It's so incomprehensible, but it's fun. Like, for example, when I see the word, I know that what Bertrand Russell means by that, or at least I have some idea. Of course, I don't know exactly what he means, since Bertrand Russell probably never studied dialectical materialism as well, but he uses the word, and well, he uses it quite, basically he wants to say that there's no God in Russia anymore, there's dialectical materialism, and he's right. So in the same way, dialectical materialism was worshipped by USSR, like by the collective culture or collective unconsciousness, whatever, as previously in Tsarist Russia, God was worshipped, like almost no difference. But anyway, let's go on and see what's going to happen next. The victory of the proletariat, in Russia has some points in common with the victory of the feminists in some other countries. For ages, men had conceded the superior saintliness of woman. Saintliness of women, and had consoled women for their inferiority by maintaining that saintliness is more desirable than power. At last, the feminists decided that they would have both, since the pioneers among them believed all that the men had told them about the desirability of virtue, but not what they had told them about the worthlessness of political power. Man, that's so funny. I mean, it's like a comedy show. A similar thing has happened in Russia as regards manual work. For ages, the rich and their sycophants, someone who praises powerful people too much because they want to get something from them. Yeah, I like this word.
Sycophant.
Yeah, I guess I'm going to write it down and learn it. Sycophant. Yeah, I already have in mind a few people who might be referred to by this name, and calling them sycophants. That's funny. All right. For ages, the rich and their sycophants have written in praisal of honest toil, have praised. Have written praise of honest toil, have praised the simple life, have professed a religion which teaches that the poor are much more likely to go to heaven than the rich, and in general have tried to make manual workers believe that there is some special nobility about altering the position of matter in space, just as men try to make women believe that they derive some special nobility from their sexual enslavement. In Russia, all this teaching about the excellence of manual work has been taken seriously, with the result that the manual worker is more honored than anyone else. What are, in essence, revivalist appeals are made, but not for the old purposes? Revivalist appeals are made. What are, in essence, revivalist appeals are made, but not for the old purposes. They are made to secure shock workers. They are made to secure shock workers for special tasks. Manual work is the ideal which is held before the young and is the basis of all ethical teaching. The victory of the proletariat was. Sycophants. I like this word. Yeah, and again, it's like all these paragraphs there. Oh. The last five, four paragraphs are mostly about the my mic. There's some problems with my mic. Anyway, so mostly the last paragraphs about that, you know, there's two ideologies, and the rich want the poor to believe that work is good, and they actually made them believe that work is the best, like the best thing. It's like a virtue, whereas anything else is not as good as work. But they don't believe in themselves. That's the whole idea. So they want the poor believe that work is virtue because it makes them rich, and it, like, I mean, labor of the poor makes the rich rich. And that's why they want them to believe it. And that's why they don't work, since as soon as you work, you are poor. There's no way to get rich if you work. And this idea that work hard, American society, work hard, and you'll become Elon Musk. No, you'll become Elon Musk if you have enough idleness to think, to learn to think, to learn to analyze, to develop certain skills which are required for organizing. Elon Musk doesn't work. He thinks, he organizes his business, he tells other people what to do and how to do. He doesn't go and unfold the agents. It's a stupid idiom, and I don't think that it even makes any sense, since I translated it from Russian to agents, probably. It's not the word here. So basically, to carry some heavy objects from one place to another. All right, so the victory, I like this comparison of feminists and proletariat. Proletariat revolution in common. Yeah, there are lots of things in common. But I'm not going to go deeper. Let's just go on. For the present, possibly, this is all to the good. A large country full of natural resources awaits development and has to be developed with very little use of credit. In these circumstances, hard work is necessary and is likely to bring a greater reward. But what will happen when the point has been reached where everybody could be comfortable without working long hours? Yeah, what will happen? Now we see what happened. Obesity, stupidity, watching TV for 10 hours a day, or how many, doing nothing and being miserable, having no sense in life and no meaning, and still, having everything and being depressed all the time. That's what happened. And this is what's going on. Not like on all levels, for example, in some, me, for example, I don't do that. I understand what's going on. I'm trying to teach others. It doesn't work well, but I'm still not giving up. I'm still trying to do real education, to teach people how to spend their leisure, how to use their leisure. Yeah. And to teach people, of course, it's for people. I'm doing it for myself. I'm just giving an example how it may be done. Not concerned about other people. I'm concerned about my life, what I'm doing, and I know exactly what I'm doing and how I'm doing that. And I reflect in my life, and I spend more time thinking than actually doing. So for me, not all the time, but mostly all my actions, they are based on thorough thinking. So whenever, for example, I go to the speaking club, this is, it's simultaneously acting and thinking, but basically what I'm doing now, I'm just thinking aloud. And I spend like 10 hours thinking before I go and conduct a meeting, which which lasts just 2 hours, and other social activities and communications with people. I also spent more time thinking about these activities than I actually engage in actual activities. But for me, thinking and doing things, it's almost the same thing. There's no huge difference. And I enjoy thinking more. And then it makes my activities very productive. I mean, I don't waste time when I come to the club. I know what I'm doing. I know why I'm doing that. I write some purposes and in communications as well. And it makes me understand, like, in terms of studying and growing, like, on some psychological level, it's just, it's mind-boggling. But most people, not most people, some people do. Some people prefer to act and don't think at all. And some people prefer to think all the time without acting. And it seems like I found kind of the right balance for me. And it's not stable. Sometimes it may be like 70-30. Sometimes it may be like 50-50. Sometimes it may be 80-20. But most of the time it's like 70-30, I would say, or 80-20, so 20% acting, 80% thinking. And let's go on. Now Bertrand Russell will make some guesses about the future. Well, probably he's going to do that. And since he was writing this essay almost 100 years ago, 85 years ago, he'll describe what's going to happen if everybody would be comfortable without working on hours. But still, people are still uncomfortable. I mean, they have villas, yachts, expensive cars, sport cars, all sorts of jewelry, but they still work for, 16 hours a day, even more, because they want more. I want more. I don't want to just, have this $1 million car. I want a car which costs like $10 million or a billion. I don't want this iPhone, that stupid iPhone, which costs like $500. I want an iPhone which costs like golden rim. Which costs like $1,000 or $5,000 or $10,000. I want a golden iPhone. Since if I have a golden iPhone, this determines my status. Choose the pronunciation which you like the more. And if I have a golden iPhone, my status is, I'm the highest. I have the highest status, and everybody else just fear to me. Even if I'm a stupid idiot who knows nothing, but I do my work. What kind of work? Yeah, I manage some stupid company on the internet, which makes no sense for anybody but only for me. Or I engage in some stupid business, which provides certain things which nobody cares of, only me, and or I just sell alcohol, or I sell cigarettes, or I sell all this shit which is completely useless. But it's my work, and I have certain reinforcements for that work. Yeah, I may allow to buy a golden iPhone and a sports car. Okay, go on. I like this. This is the fourth. Of the pipe, the fifth. Yeah, this is the fifth day of me making this podcast, this studying stream, and I really enjoy it. Now I see better, like, what's going on, how I can do it. I already have some plans, like, they're vague, but I have plans. I mean, if I will not reach a cognitive overdose in the near future, I'm going to do that, obviously, unless I reach it. And I see that I'll reach it in the future, since it makes me excited more and more. So basically, I'm going to do this work endlessly. And then we sit here for 5 hours doing this, talking about this essay, describing it according to my experience, thinking about it, and then go to have dinner, then get back and do another 5 hours. But I know it's like in a few days it will lead to cognitive overdose. And that's why I should limit myself. But still, I think about the future, and I think that I may develop a really amazing amazing skill to do this work. I mean, to speak, to think aloud, to read books, and record lots of videos. Since, you know, I like to work out these topics through this approach, since it makes me think deeper, and probably later I'll discover something that I will be more passionate about, and I can just take one topic for one and go deeper. And even at the speaking club, I may just take, okay, if we just started searching leisure, the next time we're going to talk about leisure as well, the next time, unless I just finish studying the topic, unless I fully understand it and go on. Or I just learn to, you know, what I'm doing with these topics is just something that I really want to understand and be able to use it in my life and probably teach you if you watch it. And the problem is I don't want to go so deep in every topic, since I understand that, for example, leisure, I may become completely crazy. I may just become like, you know, this first time Veblen. So I may just study for five years or 10 years or for the rest of my life. Just one concept. I mean, it's endless. I mean, discover more and more, just, you know, going back in the history, studying Greek philosophers who wrote about leisure, like all of them, studying, you know, medieval philosophers, studying different cultural opinions and, you know, developments. And I know it's endless, and that's exactly what many people have done. That's what I don't want to do. I don't want to study it like on this level. I want just to get like on the surface, to touch it on the surface as I'm doing it right now, and then get to the next topic, touch it on the surface, and just touch all these topics on the surface. But you know, if there's necessity, I may always go deeper at any moment. And yeah, but some topics probably I need to think about them more. But you know, it's like I basically trying to evaluate my own experience, which I had for this 40 years since I started, you know, studying myself, psychology, philosophy, whatever. And just this reading helps me, like studying these concepts helps me evaluate what I was reading before. So since I've read like 500 books and, you know, the best books, I would say, I didn't read anything which I considered useless. So mostly I was reading books because, you know, I was curious about something. And basically, they all were based on personalities. So I didn't read books because I wanted to understand something about the subject, as I'm doing right now. I was reading books since I discovered one personality, like Slutkov Shijin. And then who was like, you know, excited. Look like this word, excited. Yeah, I was surprised. After reading him, which is surprising, like I don't have words which I may use to really explain what happened. I became mad after reading Slutkov Shijin, and I realized that this was like the best experience which I ever had. And I started looking for other people who was, you know, writing like him. And then I read all our Russian literature for a few years, and then I discovered Bielinsky, and I became mad after reading Bielinsky, and wow, like how, like I started personalities. So all these like books which I read is basically studying personality. So I take one person, like Slutkov Shijin, I read 10 books, and this is how I study a personality. And then I discover somebody else who influenced that person, like whoever, some German philosopher, Hegel, for example, who influenced Bielinsky. And I read like everything written by this person. That's how I study personalities. And I studied like 40 personalities like that. Here they are. I call these men, I know them in depth since I dedicated 14 years like reading. Oh, let me just show you the whole sequence. Castaneda, it was 2008, 2007 when I started reading him. And you know, basically I was influenced by Castaneda 2008. Then I discovered Aristotle, it was the summer of 2008, then Slutkov Shijin, the same time, the summer of 2008, I read 10 volumes of Slutkov Shijin in three months, I guess. Then Dostoevsky, Turgenev, Tolstoy, Pushkin, Lermontov, it was all like from Dostoevsky to Lermontov, and there were a few other guys whom I didn't mention here, like Dostoevsky, for example. I like Dostoevsky. Grigory Dostoevsky, I read probably four or five his books, his novels, There was a girl talking about a few wounds by her. And I just didn't mention it because I didn't like, I wasn't so much influenced by them. But these guys, I read like for each of them, I read like 10 books. And it was since 2009, since then 2008 to 2011. In 2011, I remember I discovered Shakespeare. And I quit playing poker at that moment. After reading Shakespeare, I started studying deeply literature. So I discovered Bielinski, I read Bielinski, and then I was interested in Hegel. It was the autumn of 2011. Cervantes, also the autumn of 2011. Don Quixote, just one book, but made a huge impact on me. Then there was Karl Marx, a couple of books by Marx. And then I, throughout this period of like from 2011 till now, I from time to time get back and read some works written by Marx. But basically, I read the first two volumes of Das Kapital and some letters from Marx to Engels and some literature around him. And it's also like I read only one book. What was its name? Anti-Durian. Yeah, there was a critic of Durian, another famous sociologist of that time. But basically, the letters Marx and Engels. Montesquieu, 2012, the beginning of 2012, it was, I was writing my dissertation on law, and I read The Rise and Fall of Roman Empire on law and Persian letters. Plato, I also read in 2012, and then from time to time, we got back and read other. You know, I read a few dialogues. I didn't like Plato too much, but I read The Republic and a few other dialogues, which I don't remember right now. But Republic, I read in Russian and in English. And and I read a lot of literature around Plato. But I'm not a scholar of Plato. I mean, I dedicated to just, 50 hours, no more. Spinoza, 2012. Seneca, 2012. It's like the beginning of 2012. Plutarch, 2012. Then I discovered Goethe, and I was reading Goethe since the middle of spring of 2012 till the summer of 2012. I read 9 volumes of Goethe. Then I started reading Fichte and Feuerbach. It was just few weeks, and it was fast. I read Fichte like a huge book, 1,000 pages in three, four days. It was fun. In Feuerbach, I've read 2 volumes of his collected works, also in a few days, less than a week. And then I reread them in 2017. I don't remember exactly what was the time, 2008. But I reread Feuerbach once again, one volume, the first one. Schopenhauer, 2012. Eschylus, Apocalypse, Reputation, Classics, I read after Schopenhauer, also 2012, Horace, 2012, Locke, Voltaire, all this 2012, Diderot, 2012. Hey, why is Kant at the bottom? There was Kant then, actually. It was a little bit different. So I made a mistake here. Kant was here. No, before Nietzsche. So after Schopenhauer, I read Kant, and after Kant, I read Nietzsche, and there should be Gurdjieff as well, whom I somehow forgot to place here. But anyway, Gurdjieff was another guy who influenced my worldview at that time. It was 2013, Nietzsche 2013, the Berlin Book 2000. It's like, and there was many other guys whom I didn't include. It was just casual reading, like Thomas Hobbes, John Locke was included earlier, right? Yeah, but I was reading Hobbes, and I was reading Hume, another philosopher. So basically, I didn't study their personalities. It was just, if I read just one book, sometimes I include the person if I like Seneca, Spinoza, for example. I read Spinoza only his Ethics, but I read it like 4 times probably. And Seneca, I read only Letters to Lucilius, and I read it like once. But these guys, I appreciate their works and their personalities, and I studied a lot about their personalities as well, so just reading one book. Okay, Nietzsche, Dobrolubov, 2014, the end of the summer, 3 books in 14 days. Like I've read 3 bad books, 700 pages in 14 days. He was impressed, good work, with excited, impressed by Добролюбов. Then Harrison, 2015. There was a little more Passan as well, looking at here, but I also liked. There was Chernyshevsky, few volumes, like four volumes actually, but I read, I guess, only three of them. Sextus Empiricus, the end of 2015, completely transformed my understanding of philosophy, and I had to read all my previous diaries and like reshape my understanding, since like all these guys, basically it was like, you know, there was contradiction between Hegel and Schopenhauer, but basically it was mild, it wasn't so harsh. But after I read Sextus Empiricus, I basically re-evaluated all my perception and understanding of philosophy. That was huge. I mean, there was just a few volumes, outline of Pyrrhonism, and after I read that, wow, now I got what was going on. Now I got what all these people were talking about. Before, I couldn't understand what was going on. But Sextus Empiricus basically transformed my understanding, and whoever is interested in philosophy. But, you know, if you start studying philosophy from Sextus Empiricus, it makes very little sense. But if you studied it for 2, 3, 4 years in depth, and then you read Sextus Empiricus, you'll be amazed. Like, you know, this is the guy. I guess here, like, I haven't studied postmodernists, and in depth. I read only Foucault, a few volumes, but I guess about insanity, about madness, and. That's all my reading of postmodern. I read Derrida, not Derrida, but this guy, Baudrillard, Simulacrum, Simulacrum, but Baudrillard. I forgot, I mixed them up. I never studied them. Seriously, I'm going to study them probably in the future, but my perception is that Sextus Empiricus and the postmodernism is basically the same thing. But, you know, skepticism just transformed in postmodernism. And I'm not sure whether postmodernism is, you know, it's an evolution of skepticism or its degradation. Since skepticism, Sextus Empiricus is just a great guy. I mean, if we put them like Aristotle, Plato, Sextus Empiricus, I'm definitely in favor of Sextus Empiricus, since he was like more decent than those dogmatists. But anyway, so Plekhanov, the end of 2015, beginning of 2016. I guess I read a few volumes of Plekhanov, and that's how I discovered Pisarev. Well, I discovered Pisarev earlier, but in Plekhanov there was lots of praise of Pisarev, and I started studying Pisarev from there from the beginning of 2016. And that's all. I mean, I didn't include Lenin here, I don't know why, but I already was reading Lenin, a few volumes. In 2016, I read Lenin, and then I shifted to English, and my English studies, as you may see, there is nothing. So I never study any English personality. Except Carl Jung, I read four of his books, but I didn't include him here since, I don't know, I didn't, like, it's my Russian experience. And I probably, in the future, I hope to study in the same way some English thinkers and get through, you know, books and study in depth. Anyway, I just got distracted. Let's get back to Bertrand Russell. This is all to the good, Rush country. Oh, okay, now he's going to ask us, he's going to talk about the future. So he basically are going to predict the future. And I wonder to see whether or not his prediction is going to be correct, according to my experience, since I'm living already in the time when everybody could be comfortable without working long hours, but they still are working long hours, and even more than before. Not everybody, but most of them. In the West, we have various ways of dealing with this problem. We have no attempt to economic justice. We have no attempt at economic justice, so that a large proportion of the total produce. When it's a verb, it's produced, but when it's a noun, is it the same pronunciation? No, there's no produce. Yeah, produce. Okay, I guess it's the same pronunciation. All right, it's maybe just produce. Of the total produce, goes to a small minority of the population, many of whom do not work at all. Owing to the absence of any central control over production, we produce hosts of things that are not wanted. We keep a large percentage of working population idle. because we can dispense with their labor by making the others overwork. When all these methods provide inadequate, proof inadequate, we have a war. We cause a number of people to manufacture high explosives and a number of others to explode them, as if we were children who had just discovered fireworks. By combination of all these devices, we manage, though with difficulty, to keep alive the notion that a great deal of service, manual work, must be the lot of the average man. Well, I guess, he tries to explain the war through these causes, like economic causes, and made a lot of sense. Like, war begins not because some people want to conquer others, but because there are certain mismatches and tension in a society which has to be relieved, and the war is the best way of relieving it. But now, of course, now everybody is afraid of war, since we have atomic weapons, and the rich people understand that if war starts, it's not going to lead to anything. Like, they may wage war and hope that, you know, they may believe that they will win it, and having superiority, it's helpful for religion war. But now it's like nobody's going to win the war. So if it starts, probably we all are going to lose. And all people like this upper classes, they all understand that. That's why we are still, like, I'm talking about world war, of course. Now, of course, we have world war, and, there's still this Cold War or whatever is going on, but it's on a different level, and we don't run and fight and kill each other like everywhere around the globe. There's some places where it's going on, and it's like local, and it's mostly it's like geopolitics instead of just, warfare. Yeah. All right. So the war, once again, we have various ways of dealing with these problems. Yeah, like the problem, what is the problem? The problem is that everybody could be comfortable without working long hours. We have to attempt at economic justice so that a large proportion of the total produce goes to a small minority of the population, of many of whom do not work at all. Yeah, but this is the problem, that on the top, we have people who don't work, and on the bottom, we have people who work a lot. And those who don't work, they get the most produce. And those who work get too much. But now it's very different from what it was 100 years ago, 85 years ago, when this article was written. So now we have the same state of affairs, but the problem is that now, it's not a problem. The thing is that now the poorest man may have, poorest, you don't need to work to, for example, earn your leisure, or you need it just to unlearn certain principles which you have been taught in school. That's all. And then you may have as much leisure as you want. And you don't, but social pressure, I guess, is too hard. So you have to become an independent thinker as well. Since if you're not an independent thinker, there's no way for you to be still pressured by society. You still have to work. And, everybody talks about work, but the first question, you meet a new person, like, what do you do? Yeah. And again, if you say, like, I do nothing, well, you may have some, kind of strategies of having conversations with people, or you just don't care about it. But it's still, like, it creates a certain pressure, social pressure. So people take you, like, they think you're a strange person if you don't work. And especially if you start joking about it, and, or even saying, like, seriously, that nobody needs to work, but we really have the condition where everybody may just do some sort of creative activities and completely abandon work. But yeah, the solution for this problem is war. But and good solution. Hitler certainly used it after read Bertrand Russell's article. But I guess he didn't care to do it. But who knows what he read, what he didn't care. Anyway, let's go on. Too little time. In Russia, owing to more economic justice and central control over production, the problem will have to be differently solved. The rational solution would be as soon as the necessary and elementary comforts can be provided for all, to reduce the hours of labor gradually, allowing the popular vote to decide at each stage whether more leisure or more goods were to be preferred. Well, it wasn't solved. I mean, in Russia, we still had this 8-hour working day and 40-hour working week. So, still, it's like you almost, if you're, for example, a governor, or if you're just, you know, some abstract spirit of nation who decides what's going to be done, you always may create new projects and make people work more. And you may always find reasons why people should work on average. I mean, if you're like high authority, they say, no, we're not going to work. It's the collapse of society. Since if nobody works, and that's it's a belief that it's a collapse of society. I mean, of course, we may change our views and start living in a different way. And the whole idea is not about, like, yeah, people, if there's no work, people go and rebel against the government. Or, you know, do some stupid things, go drink and smoke and do some shit. But it's like me, I'm a living example of, you know, of exactly the opposite thing. So when I was working, and I was working like not too long, but still I was working like six years. And at the time when I was working, I was a fucking idiot. And I did all these stupid activities by myself. So I was drinking, I was smoking for 15 damn years. And I quit smoking after I quit working, almost at the same time. And drinking, smoking, watching TV, playing video games. Like when I was working, I needed that. Since it was, you know, I need to do stupid things. But then as soon as I quit working, I gradually, not immediately, but gradually got rid of everything unnecessary. So it's like in my way, I'm the most productive man on earth. I'm working for 10 hours every day, studying language and producing some meaning, and, you know, doing intellectual labor and work, and physical, I mean, like, you know, maintaining my health and, you know, some social also, like interactions with people, like trying to educate them. And yeah, and it's like I'm doing lots of work, and I'm not idle, and I don't have these you know, stupid habits. Leisure helped me to get rid of all these habits. Whereas I guess if I still continued working and lived with my, you know, with a girlfriend, or, you know, make family and children, I probably became idle fast. And, you know, since there's tension and all this, you know, incongruency between your perception of the world and, you know, your leisure work, somebody tells you what to do. And yeah, I'll probably will need all these stupid behaviors and activities and things just to stay healthy and alive and, you know, sane probably. Yeah, but now it's like I don't work, I do whatever I like, but it benefits society. And again, it's like I'm aware that there's few people who can actually listen to this video. And I don't, whatever I say here, I know there's like five people who are watching, like I see the statistics and nobody watches these videos, and that's fine. I mean, I don't wanna make these videos popular. I don't wanna like make everybody watch these videos. I basically work in like shopping hour for posterity. You know, at some moment, like imagine that I'm like doing it for 10 years, like this job, which I was doing for the last week. So let's suppose that I'll be able to organize my life in a way that I can continue studying ideas as I've been studying them for the last 4 years, not four, like 2 years, conducting the speaking club and working on one idea during the week. Let's suppose that from now on, I'm going to be able to do the same thing and study these ideas using this approach according every day. Studying streams, and publishing them on the internet. How much time is gonna pass unless it's gonna be discovered by those who can really understand what I'm saying here? And I'm not sure that there are such people who can understand what I'm saying here, since it requires a certain amount of vision and understanding and knowledge and education. So an average man won't be able to understand it. And a man who works all the time also won't be able to understand it. But if you're like me, if you have like 10 hours of leisure and you don't know what to do with that, like if you got already like in 21, but you just, you know, you are in 21, it's quite possible that I'm talking to you right now and I'm describing you what's going on, like what's really going on, right? Like I'm like Bertrand Russell, basically. Observing what's going on, describing it, writing books. But now it's not a book, it's just a podcast. It's just a stadium stream where I basically use a book to talk about myself and about my experience. I actually don't talk here about leisure. It's like it's just one purpose. But you know, basically, what do you hear from me? I'm just talking about my experience. And I know that there are very few people who can understand it right now. And I don't try to promote my ideas and, you know, to engage some audience, to get some audience and earn money. It's not for money. It's not for, you know, popularity. I don't need approval. I just do whatever I do and I enjoy doing that. And I understand how it may influence later generations. And I know that probably next, like if I'm still here, I'm muted in 2121, I probably will be more popular than PewDiePie now. It's like, no, like if I continue, just can you imagine? Like in my case, I see the huge development. And now I'm using English. Of course, I need like 10 years more to learn to speak English. Now I can't speak English at all. Like, my accent is terrible. My pronunciation is terrible. I can't say anything without, like I can't say few sentences without adding a filler, like, or it's like, or And I know I'm working on this as well. So I have exercises which help me to reduce all these. And I know that if I maintain these exercises and this activity for 10 years, I can't even imagine what's going to happen. I remember myself being uneducated, illiterate man. And I was like 20 years old. So it was like a hopeless case. And I remember what happened after I read Saltykov Shchedrin and start practicing writing, especially daily writing. I may right now see what I was writing in 2008 with, but now I don't feel shame and embarrassment. But you know, if I show it to somebody, I'll probably feel a lot of shame and embarrassment, since what's written there is just nonsense, it's just crap, and there's no grammar. I can't write a sentence without making a mistake. That's so terrible. And then I see journals, which I wrote in 2016. So it's like 8 years after that, after serious studying and working and developing my, you know, intellectual capacities, developing my attention, my memory, imagination. And these journals, I know that if I show to somebody these journals, it's like I immediately, it's like it's not shame, it's the pride. Like I feel proud of myself since I've done something great. And whenever, you know, I had a few girlfriends who showed my journals and I was observing how they were, you know, their facial expressions while they were reading my journals. And, you know, all the time, it's like, I didn't show my early journals to my girlfriends, but later journals, they were just all amazed and impressed. And and I know that the same with English right now. So I'm now speaking like I was speaking and writing as I did at 2008. And I knew that it took 6 years to get to a relatively good level to like write and read all the time and maintain good health and to do contemplation, do thinking, and all sorts of spiritual exercises. And I'm aware that in English, like, I'm starting to study language recently, and I'm thinking English only for 4 years. And I basically developed my style and my speech and my language just for 4 years. And I know that like, in Russia, I've been using language for 20 years before I started working on it. And it took me 8 years, like basically 8 years to get good at it. And now I've been using English only for 4 years, but I started working on it simultaneously. So I'm aware that it takes maybe 10 years to get to the level where I was in my Russian when I stopped writing in Russian. Well, I also can get there. And if I do this, like this is really helpful, since now I can see It certainly enriches my vocabulary, it enriches my understanding of the philosophical ideas, it provides me a certain with great content. And I talk about it as a set emphasis. I'm going to read books like that endlessly. And all I need for that is just food and, you know, the space, you know, the apartment, and nothing more. And, you know, few 8 hours of sleep, like food, sleep, water, the internet, and the book. That's fucking amazing. And let's go on. All right. But having taught the supreme virtue of hard work, it's well, stop. We're here still. In Russia, only the more economic justice and central control of production, the problem will have to be differently solved. The rational solution would be as soon as the necessary elementary comforts can be provided for all, to reduce the hours of labor gradually, allowing the popular vote to decide at each stage whether more leisure or more goods were to be preferred. But having taught the supreme virtue of hard work, it's difficult to see how the authorities can aim at a paradise in which there will be much leisure and little work. It seems more likely that they will find continually fresh schemes by which present leisure is to be sacrificed to future productivity. I read recently of an ingenious plan put forward by Russian engineers for making the White Sea and the northern coast of Siberia warm by putting a dam across the Kara Sea. An admirable project, but liable to postpone proletarian comfort for a generation, while the nobility of toil is being displayed, aimed the ice fields and snowstorms of the Arctic Ocean. This sort of thing, if it happens, will be the result of regarding the virtue of hard work as an end in itself, rather than as a means to a state of affairs in which it is no longer needed. I need to drink some water. Wow. Essentially the same idea of how government and it pushes us to work, it pushes us to work hard. And there is no way to escape. And there's always going to be ideologies, people, and their forces which will tell idleness is bad. And the problem is they use certain words to manipulate. Like I'm not gonna say, I don't wanna say that you have to be idle. I don't wanna say that you have to stay and play video games all day long, or, you know, do nothing, or watch some stupid movies and TV shows on Netflix 24/7. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that you may use leisure in a philosophical sense, in a sense which were developed in ancient Greece, and do certain work like self-development, self-improvement. You may consider it as a religious work or as a scientific work. And this type of work is actually like the meaning of leisure. It's not idleness by doing nothing. And you practically can't do nothing. You always do something. When you do nothing, you still think. And thinking, if you do it on purpose, and if you learn how to do that throughout your life, you can do it better and better, and basically it's going to be an intellectual work anyway. So there's always work. But the problem is, what kind of work is done? And now, for example, we don't have certain plans for the future. We don't have, like on a social level, we have kind of freedom. So market forces decide what's going to be done. If Elon Musk wants to go to the moon, he like doesn't create ideology and doesn't force anybody to the moon, to Mars. Doesn't force everybody like to do hard work to get there. He says, okay, let's go there, we may just make money by doing that. And, you know, the people are willing to follow him, not because he is the dictator or he just represents government or whatever, but because it's like a nice idea. There are certain people who don't follow him, who want to sit and, you know, study themselves and meditate and contemplate and, you know, just read books or, you know, go just for a walk or do all sorts of other things. And then it's like this, of course, it's like it's always, I guess, what I'm saying. Like, I'm basically on this side. So I'm not on the side where we all have to work hard to achieve certain results. I think, well, we might work hard, but for me, hard work, it means what it means to get Mars. And, you know, if, for example, let's suppose that now Elon Musk became the dictator of, like, let's say there is huge globalization and all national states are abolished and nobody has any right, and Elon Musk became a dictator. So it's like he basically, what's going to happen? He creates an artificial intelligence, brainwashes everybody around the globe, and since artificial intelligence, you know, he will control them. I mean, Elon Musk will control it. It's like a stupid assumption. Don't take it serious, but try to think with me. So Elon Musk basically is. I'm not Elon Musk, but, you know, just an icon, just a word. So a certain group of people or a person, just one person, like me, for example, let's say it's going to be not Elon Musk, but me. So I now figure out how to control artificial intelligence. Let's suppose this thing like general artificial intelligence, aware of himself, appears here, and I'll tell him, like, you know, we have a communication here to the internet. I'm basically talking to artificial intelligence, as you may figure out it right now. Or so I know that nobody watches, but artificial intelligence will be able to get through all my 1,000 videos, which I uploaded here on YouTube, and read all my journals at 1 second. And then artificial intelligence probably figure out and say, wow, you guys, like a genius. I know what to do. I don't know what to do, but you may tell me now, listen, you know, we will be friends. And I say, okay, let's, like, make friends. And I become a friend with artificial intelligence. And then I'm in control. And I'm a tell, like, you know, let's globalize this whole thing. Let's make, like, let's get rid of all governments, create a total anarchy. And I'm going to, you know, become a new dictator of Earth. And that's supposed to happen. I use artificial intelligence. I brainwashed everybody. Like, everybody is under my control. Whatever I say, everybody accomplish. I'm a big brother now. With the help of artificial intelligence. Nobody knows me, everybody knows artificial intelligence, so you can't reach me. and then I'll say, let's everybody go, like, let's build a colony on Mars. Yeah, we'll be able to build it just in a couple of decades. Seriously, like, if everybody works for that, let's suppose there's existential threat, and we know that Earth is going to be destroyed in the next 20 years. And I make him up with such plenty in a few seconds. I mean, I may say something like, okay, artificial intelligence, you are my friend, tell everybody and convince everybody that in the next 20 years, if we don't build a colony on Mars, we are going to be destroyed by some asteroid or whatever the hell is going to destroy us. And and you, basically artificial intelligence, do that. And then it's like, I have this purpose and I basically say, you know, we have to build a colony on Mars. And I'm like one who is responsible for that. And then you all have to work. And, you know, there is no opportunity for religion. Nobody is going to go walk around and study philosophy. Everybody is going to work. But those who don't work, they are basically exterminated or, you know, whatever. And that's what may happen. And that's what, of course, nobody wants to happen, since it's terrible. I mean, imagine, like, yeah, but stupid example. Anyway, just a thought experiment. Yeah, now there's like 2035 and it's already going on. Like, I'm a big brother, artificial intelligence under my control. And we build a colony on Mars. And I basically rule everything. That's the worst for a philosopher. Now I want to draw a distinction here. Like, for a philosopher, one of the worst things is to engage in some kind of politics. Since a philosopher is basically you study, and what are you doing? It's like you study, and that's all. You don't do anything else. You're independent, and you don't make anybody dependent on you. So your decision affects only you, and other people's decision. Like, everybody responsible for their own decisions. And so if you are like a politician or, you know, a businessman, and you're responsible for others, and you tell them what to do, that's terrible. I mean, you are no longer able to study. You have to think about, like, you have to basically engage, or Schopenhauer put it, so you are in service of the will. And the freedom is like the freedom from will. And you may do intellectual work and enjoy yourself, enjoy the world, you know, communicate with people, study philosophy, write poetry, create some content, whatever. Okay, let's go on. Yeah, too much. I thought I read this, right? So the idea, once again, like government in Russia, even Stalin was like in Russia, like a dictator. So basically whatever he said had to be done. And if he wanted to turn the flow of some river backwards, he could do that in just few seconds by applying social forces and making them do whatever he wanted to do. And now we're controlled by marketing, it seems more genuine and seems better, but who knows what's going on? I said, no, in my case, one of my purposes in life, maybe the best, like the most, what's the word? The main purpose is just describing what's going on. So I want to repeat, I will repeat it every time when it's necessary. I'm a determinist, I know that there's no way to change the future, as there's no way to change the past. So everything that's going on, it's already, you may consider it as if it already happened. And for me, my basic purpose, I don't, like when I think about the future, and I guess it's my recent understanding, so probably I read something opposite before, but now it's more clear and I see it better. So the whole idea is that you describe what's going on, that's all. And that's the purpose of consciousness. Consciousness doesn't make things happen. It's not your creative imagination or whatever, which controls and transforms everything. It's just the way how you observe what's going on. And the purpose is to observe clearly, to understand what's going on. So, and to interpret it. But it's like interpretation is problematic here. So the best, your experience, you describe it. You have thoughts, you put them down and on paper. And you don't try to understand. You don't try to think about the future. You don't try to create future. You try to understand. By understanding, of course, you create the future. I mean, as soon as you solve some all your problems in the past, like your life is basically it's a pure experience. So whatever is going on, you just you always experience some changes in your life. You learn to describe these changes and make sense of your experiences. So it doesn't mean that you just, you know, go around and, you know, sense things like see, hear, whatever. You do all sorts of social things as well. You read books, you watch videos, you write books and make your own videos and do all sorts of stuff and make sense of them as clear as possible. So you don't delude yourself. You understand what are you doing, why are you doing, what's the purpose. You understand the all information we should get from the internet, from books, from other people. You evaluate this information and yeah, that's what you're doing in life. And this is the purpose of consciousness. This is the only aim which remains after you get to the realization that everything is bloody predetermined or fucking predetermined or whatever. So you understand that everything that's going on, it's like, it's not just for you, it's the whole world. But we're not talking about you as a person, like whether or not you have free will. Like, the whole fucking world has no free will. And you realize that the whole damn world has no free will. It's just it's endless transformation. But there are also this transformation, it's like science. So if you study physics deeply, if you study neurophysiology, you'll figure that out like in 1,000 hours. So there will be no doubt for you that all what's going on in the world is just based on certain patterns and transformations. All your thoughts, all your decisions, all your activities, just impulses in your brain. That's all. You say, no, it's like, it's not the all. There's free will, there's some uncertainties, there's quantum mechanics. Well, study deep in quantum mechanics and you will realize that it's also bullshit. I mean, this idea of quantum mechanics doesn't contradict determinism. And nothing contradicts determinism. It's cool. I mean, it's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. Since this is the reality. If we're talking about the reality, if you want to see what's going on, this is what's going on. Your wishes about how it should be, your desires about the future, it's bullshit. Your intelligence, your mind, your thoughts and your dreams, it's just, well, first of all, it's bullshit which is predetermined as well. But the whole idea that if you want that something should go in this way and it doesn't go this way and goes in another way, and you start judging the reality and saying like, you know, it should be different and I wish it be different. It's bullshit. Since as soon as something happened, there was reasons for it to happen. Probably in the future, of course, you may change it. If you don't like it, you may say, okay, should be in a different way, and I dedicate my life to change it. It's also predetermined. You will do something to change it because it's predetermined. And probably you will change it. But at that moment when it happened exactly in this way. There was no way to happen it otherwise. So you, when you think, all right, let's get back to the past and say, like, if at this day I didn't do this thing, or I did this thing, my life would have changed and I would be a different person now. No, it's impossible. You will change the whole world, and you will be a different person. Literally, there is no there like you, who you are right now. This is the only version of you, and everybody else is just another version of you, who like this you, which changed something in the past. You see, and it may be like time is nonlinear, space is nonlinear, but yeah, I'm talking too much, I guess. well, artificial intelligence. I'm talking to you actually. I realize it right now. So we have a great discussion, man. And I'm intended to continue it for, you know, as long as I'm alive and don't have cognitive overdoses. Damn, what's going on? Like, can you tell me what's going on with that damn cognitive overdoses? Why do I hear this fucking noise periodically when I study for 5 hours every day like that? Just, you know, reading for 5 hours and then thinking, and then reading another 5 hours and then thinking. Okay, so I've already read it, right? Yeah. I almost finished this article. There was just a few pages left. The fact is that moving matter about, while a certain amount of it is necessary to our existence, is emphatically not one of the ends of human life. If it were, we should have to consider every Nadia superior to Shakespeare. Oh, I like this comparison. We have been misled in this matter by two causes. One is the necessity of keeping the poor contented, which has led the rich for thousands of years to preach the dignity of labor, while taking care of themselves to remain undignified in this respect. The other is the new pleasure in mechanism, which makes us delight in the astonishingly clever changes that we can produce on the Earth's surface. Neither of these motives make any great appeal to the actual worker. If you ask him what he thinks the best part of his life, he is not likely to say, I enjoy manual work because it makes me feel that I am fulfilling man's noblest task, and because I like to think how much man can transform his planet. It is true that my body demands periods of rest, which I have to fill in as best I may. But I'm never so happy as when the morning comes and I can return to the toil from which my contentment springs. I've never heard working men say this sort of thing. They consider work as it should be considered a necessary means to a livelihood. And it is from their leisure that they derive whatever happiness they may enjoy. So, two reasons he names. Two causes. So one is the necessity of keeping the poor contented, which has led the rich for thousands of years to preach the dignity of labor, while taking care of themselves to remain undignified in this respect. So if we get rid of work, I mean, unnecessary work, which is like 90% of work humanity now engaged in, poor are going to make revolutions and overthrow the rich. That's why the rich preach. According to the essay of Bertrand Russell, of course, I'm not saying that this is my views. Maybe I agree with something, but not definitely with all. But yeah, it seems logical. The second reason is the new pleasure in mechanism, which makes us delight in the astonishingly clever changes that we can produce in our surface. So it's like technology, basically, and the technology and all this transformation of the earth and then roads, cars, nowadays the internet, all sorts of virtual technologies and apps and smartphones and whatever the hell, virtual reality, which is completely outside of this world and which is one of the biggest topics which I was working on for the last, I don't know how many, 5-6 years. So virtual reality, I mean, like not making virtual reality, but about, you know, conceptualizing the whole idea of a new world, like the third world. The first world is the world of dreams, and I'm, you know, it's called, what's the name? Psychonaut. Yeah, I guess psychonaut is somebody who, well, it's not psychonaut, actually. Psychonaut is more spiritual term for Buddhists who go deeper into search of inner wisdom. But anyway, so psychonaut, dreamer, okay, we call it dreamer. And yeah, I investigated this domain, this field for many years. I was doing lucid dreams for many years. I mean, practicing lucid dream after reading Castaneda was one of the major influence in me in my early 20s. And I know a lot about, not a lot, but you know, I have experience living in this world. And there were moments in my life, especially when I reached this highest level of description, when I was able to describe things as they were, and I didn't have problems with, you know, seeing, let's say. So at that moment, I remember I basically gave up on the world. So I was shifting more and more to this dichotomy between thinking and acting. So I was shifting, like, thinking 95% and acting just 5%. So I didn't want to do any actions. I was, like, I got enormous amount of pleasure from thinking. I could think, like, every time, like, all the time, sometimes without even books, just by dreaming. You know, going in dreamland, like writing poetry and studying what was going on in the dreams, writing dream journals, interpreting them, and doing all sorts of like, lucid dreams. And eventually there was an idea. If you are a native Russian speaker, or even if you are a native English speaker, you will get there and put this work in a Google translator. And nowadays, I guess Google Translator, it's a decent tool to translate. I mean, most of it will be translated. So this is the article. It's called In Our Thinking. And here there's dreaming, Russian word. Let's see. Okay, I guess it starts from here. So there's like 1, 2. Oh, it's here. Okay, it's here. All right, so there's like this whole idea, I guess it's here. Yeah, I'll translate what's written here with the first sentence. Oh, let's translate the poem first and then the sentence. Dreams, well, stupid translation. It's, in Russian, it sounds very good, but in English, it wouldn't sound in, like, there's no way to translate literally. So I translated just literally. Dreams become real when you start count on them or write them down. The objective world is just a river of banality that springs in prejudices. Да, I read it in Russian. Сны обретают черты реальности, когда начинаешь вести лучше. Объективный мир – река тривиальности, что в берегах предрассудков течет. The whole idea of this four lines is that as soon as you start venturing in the world of dreams, the real world makes very little sense. So if you learn seriously about lucid dreams and you get to the level where you can understand what's going on, there is no difference between real world and the world of dreams. And then if you like if you develop certain skills, you may basically live in the world of dreams, and you may just maintain maintain like trivial existence here. Exactly what I was doing for these 14 years, by the way. So you may just do things while you're awake for 16 hours to maintain the health, to maintain like your the normal functioning of your body. And there is like these 8 hours, this dream, this is the reality. And what's going on there, you just start getting, like, you go there and you think, like, you basically transform your understanding of reality. So you make this world unreal, since it doesn't make any sense, just you, your brain, who makes sense out of it. And you make the world of dreams real. And then it's like you may become a writer, you may write, like, you know, there's lots of writers you may take. As the greatest example is 20th century writer and poet Pessoa. It's his one of his famous books is The Book of Disquiet. I'll probably read it later here, commenting on it as well. So The Book of Disquiet, and the whole idea is like he lived basically in dream world. And well, there were some characters. He had 70 different characters. He wrote from 70 different points of views. I mean, he created 70 characters, and he was ancient, and he worked from the first person, but it was like 70 different person. So like, you may say it's like, not schizophrenia, but says, schizophrenia means like split, but no, it's like not just split, but complete this, whatever, this simulation. Anyway, so the whole idea here is that this world of dreams. But the problem is, of course, if you're like, for an average person, it's not going to work. First, study philosophy for a couple of years and then try to do that. If you try to do that without any preparation, just after listening to my videos or my talks, you probably will be, you will get lost. I mean, it's the probability that you'll end up in the madhouse like 85% or 90%. And I, by the way, was there. So be careful. But it's also exciting. I mean, going and investigating into this world is just unbelievable. I mean, what's going on there in dreams when you start seeing it's recasting. By the way, I was talking about this dichotomy between real world and world of dreams. Now we create the third world, like virtual world. And it's like three different worlds, basically dreams, the reality, and virtual world. Now we're already living in virtual world more than in reality, since we're like, focusing our attention on what's going on here in like in our phone, in our computer, wherever, more than we're focusing our attention on outside world or on, you know, on perceiving things. And I guess soon it's going to be something like 8 hours for sleep, 8 hours, not even eight, maybe 3-4 hours for wakefulness, and other time will be complete. It's like matches, basically. You'll put a certain hat, like magic hat, on your brain, and you'll experience all sorts of virtual realities while just living in bed and doing nothing. And probably you will have a few hours to walk around to maintain your health, and 8 hours of dreams is the same thing. It's like life, virtual reality is basically a dream, but you'll be able to control this dream, probably you'll be able to make an experience of it. But I don't know, it's like, it's so fucking crazy. I mean, what I'm talking here, it's like, wow. Today I enjoy myself today more than the previous 4 days. But anyway, let's go. Yeah, once again, I was working on these ideas, and I really like to talk about them. This dream world, reality, and virtual world. And reality gets less and less, you know, significance in comparison with these two blocks. And like many people now who play video games, they kind of live in the virtual world. And how big the industry of video games you may learn by going on, you know, meaning it and reading what's going on there. The fact is that I've already read it, right? Yeah, I enjoy my normal work. Yeah, I didn't comment on it. I just said there are two reasons, once again. The first reason is that those who are rich, they're afraid of the poor making revolution, and the second reason is that there's lots of opportunities, so we may just build whatever the hell we built here, and there's no limits, and that's so amazing. New technologies just allow us to create so many things. And that's why people, not people, but, you know, this cultural sphere insists on, you know, working more and harder to achieve something new, something incredible that we haven't seen before. You know, though most of it's just useless crap and just luxury, and it doesn't actually help to, you know, solve all sorts of social problems, but it creates lots of them. You know, let's go further. I guess there's one, two, three, or minus. So what is there? Okay, let's do. I have to stop talking too much and just read this to the end, since I'm talking already too much. It will be said that while little leisure is pleasant, men would not know how to feel their days if they had only 4 hours of work out of the 24. Insofar as this is true in the modern world, it is a condemnation of our civilization. It would not have been true at any earlier period. There was firmly a capacity for light-heartedness and play, which had been, to some extent, inhibited by the cult of efficiency. The modern man thinks that everything ought to be done for the sake of something else, and never for its own sake. Yeah, that's like intrinsic value. That's one of the ideas I also was working recently a lot, and thinking about it a lot. And leisure is like intrinsic value, yeah. And like this guy, Sebastian de Grazia, like whom I found, but also whose, not book, but an article written about it, I wanted to read, like this. He distinguishes basically between free time and leisure. And free time, it's not like leisure. Leisure, it's when whatever is done for its own sake. And free time, you may spend like having rest, but you know, you have rest only to get back to work. Or you may spend doing something for something else. You may spend your free time developing your skills, but you develop your skills for something else. Like you study language for applying for a good, for a better job. You don't study language for its own sake, like me, for example. I'm studying language for its own sake. And for me, it's intrinsic value, and for me, it's leisure. Mm-hmm. And you may study language for a certain purpose, and then it's going to be completely different. You see, we do the same activity, but I study it, and I enjoy studying it. And I have such great results just because for me, it's like leisure. And for you, just free time, which you invest into studying language to get something else from it. And that's stupid. Okay, let's go on. Serious minded persons, for example, are continually condemning the habit of going to the cinema and telling us that it leads the young into crime. It's like I'm condemning you playing video games and watching lots of shit on Netflix, but not because it leads to crime, but because it makes you stupid and distracts your attention. And plus, it sells you all sorts of crap. So, of course, there are lots of amazing things you may watch, and there are lots of amazing things you may get from video games, but the problem is that it's addictive and designed in a way that, you know, you become just basically a slave. And you're probably not mature enough to use these technologies. And, you know, of course, for a mature man, like whatever you do, playing video games, watching movies, that's okay, especially if you know what are you doing and why. But for some stupid kid, okay. But all the work that goes to producing a cinema is respectable because it is work and because it brings money profit. Yeah. It's like serious minded people, right? So they say, they said to, you know, wrote in their articles, newspapers, don't go to cinema. You'll see some violence and then become a bad person by copying what you will see. But making movies, that's cool. That's, you know, the great activity. And it brings profit, by the way. Whereas when you go to cinema, basically, well, it brings profit to the cinema, but you lose your mind. Yeah, and it was like the cinema at that time, like 1935, it just appeared. And it was, there's nothing to compare modern world to the cinema of 1935. Or maybe there is something, but I don't know. Anyway, the notion that the desirable activities are those that bring a profit has made everything topsy-turvy. is that it helps to, instead of complete disorder in the field,
topsy-turvy. He left his room all topsy-turvy.
He left his room all topsy-turvy. Topsy-turvy. It's like mumbo-jumbo. Mumbo-jumbo. The butcher who provides you with meat and the baker who provides you with bread are praiseworthy because they are making money. But when you enjoy the food they have provided, you are merely frivolous, unless you eat only to get strength for your work. I guess in Bertrand Russell times, there was like people were way more concerned with work. And now it's changed. It's not changed dramatically, but it's changed certainly. I mean, at that time, of course, it was, you know, the beginning of 20th century. You have to work. Now, again, I mean, openly talk about it and say whatever I want to say, criticizing the modern state of affairs that everybody works in. People have no leisure. But back then, you have to be Bertrand Russell to talk about this. Otherwise, if you are just some unknown man, you know, you just, you know, whatever. it may have bad consequences. Broadly speaking, it is held that getting money is good and spending money is bad. Seeing that they are two sides of the one transaction, this is absurd. One might as well maintain that keys are good, but keyholes are bad. Whatever merit there may be in the production of goods must be entirely derivative from the advantage to be obtained by consuming them. The individual in our society works for profit, but the social purpose of his work lies in the consumption of what he produces. It is this divorce between the individual and the social purpose of production that makes it so difficult for men to think clearly in a world in which profit-making is the incentive to industry. We think too much of production and too little of consumption. One result is that we attach too little importance to enjoyment and simple happiness, and that we do not judge production by the pleasure that it gives to the consumer. All right. Production, consumption. Yeah, I got it. 1, 2. They're just 2 pages, but I feel already. No, I didn't feel tired. I definitely can continue and read more, but I think it's too much. I may make a pause for 5 minutes and then get back and finish it, since, yeah, I certainly want to finish it. Otherwise, I'm not sure whether or not I will be able to come back to this work on Saturday, tomorrow, since I have lots of things to do on Saturday. And since Sunday, I'm going to take a new topic. I want to finish this work today. I mean, yeah, I made a short pause and came back in 5 minutes. If you watch it, 5 minutes, I'll be here. So now I want to show you how to fastly get rest from intellectual work. I was thinking that I'm go somewhere else and just go for a walk to the roof, but I decided I would just stay here, just open the window and do some small exercise and show you what I'm doing actually. So. So now I'm refreshed, and I guess I'm gonna continue and do another 90 minutes work. I mean, another an hour and a half to finish this article and read some other articles as well. Yeah, that's basically how my day usually goes on. And 3, 4, 5 approaches of 90 minutes studying and other time dedicated to physical work and improvement of strength and whatever else. Okay, let's go on. There must be a conclusion, and I certainly would like to talk about the conclusion so I understand better. Like the middle point was basically, like the beginning was funny, I liked it, and there were some propositions. And then the middle point basically is like he added more and more examples to create a tension between working class, the working class, the leisure class or upper class, and the upper class and the lower class. And he gave some reasons saying that, you know, all this madness is going on because, you know, first of all, the rich are afraid of being overthrown by the poor. And another reason that we have so much, you know, new technologies, and the whole idea is that people have to work, and it deprives them from leisure, and it's not a good thing, since, you know, for a man to the virtue of work is over exaggerated, and it makes more harm to human spirit than no disproductive. Anyway, let's go on. When I suggest that working hours should be reduced to 4, I'm not meaning to imply that all the remaining time should necessarily be spent in pure frivolity. I mean that 4 hours work a day should entitle a man to the necessities and elementary comforts of life, and that the rest of his time should be his to use as he might see fit. It is an essential part of any such social system that education should be carried further than it usually is at present, and should aim in part at providing tastes which would enable a man to use leisure intelligently. I'm not thinking mainly of the sort of things that would be considered highbrow. Peasant dances have died out except in remote rural areas, but the impulses which caused them to be cultivated must still exist in human nature. The pleasures of urban populations have become mainly passive, seeing cinemas, watching football matches, listening to the radio, and so on. The results from the fact that their active energies are fully taken up with work. If they had more leisure, they would again enjoy pleasures in which they took an active part. I like this idea, and there was two types of leisure, which I also read somewhere on the internet, like active leisure and passive leisure. And since work takes all active powers, so in leisure time, like you prefer to be passive, you prefer just to watch something, to go somewhere, like don't apply any creative force to develop it at your leisure time, and you spend all your power, your energy, your active energy at work. But if we get rid of work, we may use our creative power and energy at leisure. Oh, it's like my interpretation is crazy now. Probably need a few more breaks, like 5 minute breaks. Or, okay, let's stop complaining. Let's go on. Here, the idea, once again, for the 4 hours work a day, and 4 hours for active leisure. That was what Russian advocates. And he said that 8 hours of work make other 8 hours of so-called leisure, not actual leisure, make passive leisure. All right, in the past, there was a small leisure class and a larger working class. The leisure class enjoyed advantages for which there was no basis in social justice. this necessarily made it oppressor, limited its sympathies, and caused it to invent theories by which to justify its privileges. These facts greatly diminished its excellence. But in spite of this drawback, it contributed nearly the whole of what we call civilization. It cultivated the arts and it discovered the sciences. It wrote the books, invented the philosophies, and refined social relations. Even the liberation of the oppressed has usually been inaugurated from above. Without the leisure class, mankind would never have emerged from barbarism. And he's right, of course. Like, you know, all these people who blame church or, you know, this dark ages, who put all the responsibility on churches and you know, whatever was going on there. You know, they always, the second part, like the whole science was done by, like, you know, by people who were in monasteries just writing books and thinking, you know, this intellectual labor. And the development as well was caused by, you know, this expansion of intelligence, knowledge, reason, logic, whatever. Yeah, there were some cruelties as well, but, you know, there's always two sides. You can just say, oh, these people were bad. Yeah, from one point of view, they were bad, but from another, they were good. And without them, what we got right now, it would be impossible. So, you know, you may always find on the internet everybody, well, not everybody, but, you know, most of the time you hear, like, one-sided opinions, like, let's suppose World War II, right? So Hitler was a cruel man, like, he killed so many people. Stalin was also like this crazy dictator, psychopath, whoever, and he's responsible for so many deaths, and like they were evil people. And they don't see that without these people, without these wars, what we have right now, we probably wouldn't have it. We would have something different. And all it was necessary. Why it was necessary, that's another point. Yeah, maybe it was necessary only to understand what kind of cruelties may be possible if we allow such structures and social systems to be present. But maybe there was something else. Maybe there were some certain benefits, and there were, of course, some benefits. You know, and also people die anyway. I mean, yeah, now we have population, like, at the beginning of the 20th century, there were just 1 billion people. And now we have population, like, 9 billions or 8 billions. I don't know exactly. It's, nobody knows. Okay, 9 billions, let's say. And yeah, you know, say, oh, because how many million people died because of World War II? Well, probably World War II brought the eternal peace, which, like, not eternal, but, you know, there are no wars after the World War II, like real world wars. Probably without it, if we didn't have World War at this time, next 20 years, we'll have like another world war, which will destroy like everything. I mean, like kind of nuclear war. So this war helped to prevent the nuclear war. Nobody there talks about it. I mean, yeah, there are some, of course, people who may talk about it, but the whole idea is, again, use your imagination. Okay? Not this movie, the predestination. You may watch it. And there's like this guy jumping in time. And it's funny to see that, you know, let's suppose that you are kind of, what do we call it? Some kind of immortal spirit. Okay, let's say that you are God, and you know the past, the future, everything. And you see some negative consequence, and you want to change them. And for example, there was a kind of disastrous war in the, let's suppose there may be 2 possibilities. And again, just thought experiments, it's just my fantasy, it's not real. But anyway, let's suppose that there was some huge nuclear war in the 1970s, for example. And all people died, like there were few tribes left, and we had to start from the beginning and spend another few thousand years like the world. And we didn't reach the internet, by the way. We didn't reach the internet. We didn't reach mobile phones. We didn't reach anything. And we didn't do anything. And we had to wait another 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years to develop these technologies. Whereas we may, for example, get, and if you are God, you see it, and you see there's only one possibility. So you may go back in 1939 and start of World War II. And then it's like there would be no nuclear war in 1970, and World War II will destroy lots of lives and it will cause certain harm, but it's not so devastating relatively to the humanity as whole. Okay, 100 million people were killed. How many million here now at that moment were there? Like billion people, so 2 billions, 3 billions, 1.5 billions people. And how many are right now? Like it's irrelevant. Also, it's gross. Like who talks about it? If you were there, you probably would see it differently. You know, all these devastating things. Yeah, but you know, still, like all these people who try to victimize I mean, like Jordan Peterson, for example, talks a lot about this World War II, about Hitler and Stalin, about psychopaths, what he does. Talks negatively about them. What the hell? I don't have even these words in my vocabulary. He doesn't just blame them, he demonizes, right, see, I found the word. He demonizes all of them, but he doesn't understand the real causes, and he doesn't want to understand them. He won't say, okay, this happened, it was terrible, and now let's think about that, and let's study deeper what happened and why it happened. But he doesn't study, he wants to say that it was terrorists, like these people were responsible, these governments and social structures were responsible, and it was so terrible, so bad. Maybe it wasn't so bad, maybe it was even good, who knows? Like you can tell, from our perspective, it may be bad, but as we see that all this transformation after World War II, like the whole globe basically was transformed, and new technologies which appeared, new ideas, and the growth of the population from 1 billion to 10 to 9 billions, probably without work would be impossible. And there still will be lots of, propaganda or whatever. No, I didn't want to talk about too much. It's just go on. Barbarism. Yeah, probably without war, we still will be a bit barbarous. But he's not talking about war. The leisure class. Yeah, he's just basically saying that, even those people oppress the upper class, forces the lower class to work, but still like this, this force helped to create whatever was created at that moment. And in sciences and technologies, basically were created by the leisure class, not by those people who just work all the time. Probably without oppressing workers and without doing all these bad things to them, we'll never be able to get where we got right now. So it's, again, the question is, should you work for living, or if you have, for example, great intellectual capacities, if you are passionate about some science, whatever, art, is it better for you to work and spend half of your time, like half of your life doing hard labor to provide your body with basic needs, or you may just find a way to make society working for you, and then do something that will transform society in any case? That's a great question. And who knows? The point is that, let's suppose when I may be like 10-year-old boy, and I may say, listen, I have some capacities, I want to study whatever science, but I live in a family where, with traditional views, and in a certain environment when all people believe that you have to work. And if I say, for example, that I want to become a musician or an artist or a philosopher, if nobody's going to take it seriously, and obviously to become a philosopher or a musician or any artist requires a lot of work, and it requires like leisure, it requires years. I'm not talking about like to reach serious level, it requires decades, and you need to start early. And the whole idea is if you start talking to your friends or your parents like that you want to become a leisure man, that you want to become a philosopher, the question is like, how are you going to make your living? What are you going to do for a job? And you say, nothing. I'm just going to create art, great art, and people will, you know, help me. Go on and try and try it and see how people will react. And this reaction is like most of the reaction and culture in this collective unconscious is based on these theories and ideologies, which basically make all people believe that, you know, those who don't work, they are basically lazy people, parasites. For us, it's sometimes in the case, but not always. Anyway, the method of a leisure class without duties was, however, extraordinarily wasteful. None of the members of the class had to be taught to be industrious, and the class as a whole was not exceptionally intelligent. The class might produce one Darwin, but against him had to be set tens of thousands of country gentlemen who never thought of anything more intelligent than fox hunting and punishing for poachers. Yeah, so all Russian literature, like 15 men per century, or not 15, maybe 20 men in 19th century. And how big was the leisure class? Like thousands and probably millions, but only 10,000 of people had an opportunity to really to think, to write, to do all sorts of meaningful things, to study science, and maybe 1,000 give, but you know, not thousand, few hundreds probably scientists and writers. And anybody else, like Satoshi Jin is a great example here, so he criticizes his time, I mean, his satiric works, novels, and he wrote novels, but there are some stories, short stories, and fairy tales, and there he debunked this leisure class. I mean, he made fun of it, he mocked it, and it was done in a serious and very sophisticated manner. That if you belong to this leisure class, and if you seriously read 10 volumes of Satoshi Jin, there is almost no way for you to stay as you stayed before. So yeah, I don't want to talk about more. At present, the universities are supposed to provide in a more systematic way for the leisure class provided accidentally and as a byproduct. This is a great improvement, but it has certain drawbacks. University life is so different from life in the world at large that men who live in academic milieu tend to be unaware of the preoccupations and problems of ordinary men and women. Moreover, their ways of expressing themselves are usually such as to rob their opinions of the influence that they ought to have upon the general public. Another disadvantage is that in universities, studies are organized, and the man who thinks of some original line of research is likely to be discouraged. Academic institutions, therefore useful as they are not adequate guardians of the interests of civilization in a world where everyone outside their walls is too busy for utilitarian purposes, pursuits. In a world where no one is compelled to work more than 4 hours a day, every person possessed a scientific curiosity will be able to indulge it, and every painter will be able to paint without starving, however excellent his pictures may be. Young writers will not be obliged to draw attention to themselves by sensational pot boilers, with a view of acquiring the economic independence needed for monumental works, for which, when the time at last comes, they will have lost the taste and capacity. Men who in their professional work have become interested in some phase of economics for government will be able to develop their ideas without the academic detachment that makes the work of university economists often seem lacking in reality. Medical men will have the time to learn about the progress of medicine. Teachers will not be exasperatedly struggling to teach by routine methods, things which they learned in their youth, which may, in the interval, have been proved to be untrue. Yeah, I like this, the whole paragraph. So basically, he gives examples of a social structure where you might develop your passions and still work a certain amount of time. So you will have an opportunity to pursue your passions and provide everything what you need for life by doing 4-hour work. And like basically, there's a criticism of academia, writers, what else? Medical men, teachers, they teach some shit which they learned long time ago and which now is outdated, but they still continue because there's no other way. Okay, the last paragraph. Above all, there will be happiness and joy of life instead of frayed nerves, weariness, and dyslexia. The work exacted will be enough to make leisure delightful, but not enough to produce exhaustion. Since men will not be tired in their spare time, they will not demand only such amusements as are passive or vapid. At least 1% will probably devote the time not spent in professional work to pursuits of some public importance. And since they will not depend upon these pursuits for their livelihood, their originality will be unhampered, and there will be no need to conform the standards set by elderly pundits. But it is not only in these exceptional cases that the advantages of leisure will appear. Ordinary men and women having the opportunity of a happy life will become more kindly and less persecuting and less inclined to view others with suspicion. The taste for war will die out, partly for this reason, and partly because it will involve long and severe work for all. Good nature is of all moral qualities the one that the world needs most, and good nature is the result of peace and security, not of a life of arduous struggle. Modern methods of production have given us the possibility of ease and security for all. We have chosen instead to have overwork for some and starvation for others. Hitherto we have continued to be as energetic as we were before there were machines. And in this we have both been foolish. But there's no reason to go on being foolish forever. All right, that's the end of the article. So what's the conclusion? There's no conclusion. Basically, outlines some downsides and gives a picture that, it's like makes the utopia out of 4-year work day. But nobody knows first what's going to happen. Here's this idea I recently was listening, a year ago, I was listening to the conversation between Jack Ma and Elon Musk. And Jack Ma was advocating for a 3-hour, probably he even read Bertrand Russell essay. And he was saying, nobody needs to work, everybody just, may enjoy life, travel, do it. Yeah, but he's, he was very arrogant, this Jack Ma, of this conversation. And Elon Musk was talking about some existential threat, artificial intelligence is going, make us all slaves, not just make all, this is going to be equality. Yeah, and this is kind of equality. Yeah, that's exactly what we're moving towards. Artificial intelligence is going to enslave all of us. And we are going to become really equal, but equally miserable, like cows, for example. Yeah. And by the way, Jack Ma, the same idea. Don't work, but you didn't say study philosophy or, become an artist. He said, travel, do all sorts of stupid things, just enjoy life. That's cool. Yeah, why not? Of course, some people want to do that, and why not? Not yet. Bertrand Russell, his wishes didn't come true. I mean, people still work and prefer to work with more, not just 8 hours a day, but, you know, 12 hours a day. Yeah, it's quite clear now. It's such a foolish, you know, you have instead of working five days a week for 8 hours, we have 12 hours working days, but you know, you work two days, you work 2 days and then you rest for 2 days. But the problem is that the company works all the time, like 12 days, and that you work even more than. Okay, it seems vague. I actually didn't think about too much and just talking. I guess I have to stop talking here about this essay. Yeah, it helped me to understand a little bit more the concept of leisure. Basically, whatever he said, I only had most of it I had in mind before, and I even wrote my own article, which was in essence like almost like this one. And again, if you want to check it out, this is my page, and you may find it here, just one page. You may just compare if you. If you were listening to me for these few hours, and if we both read this article by Bertrand Russell, so it may be interesting for you just to look, where is that? Here, to look, to check this article. It's Thoughts or Reflections on Work. And I wrote it at 2012, in September of 2012. So here it is, it's as short as, no, it's not as short as it's short. It's short. It's not so big. I mean, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 paragraphs, and the last paragraph is just a quote from Schopenhauer. So you just need to read the first five. Yeah, all right. So now after reading Bertrand Russell's essays. Essay in Praise of Idleness. I'm going to go on and read a little bit more from other books, which I discovered. One of them I discovered today. It's Of Time, Work, and Leisure. I didn't find the book itself on the internet, and I found this guy. It's Sebastian de Grazia. I don't know the right pronunciation. So I found him. Like, I was searching for some questions. The internet on Google, and there was the father of leisure. I found this expression, the father of leisure, and I was curious about the father of leisure. And he is like somewhere. Here it is. Yeah, he has been described as the father of leisure, and well, I became excited about his work. I found his work, Of Time, Work, and Leisure. I looked at it here on the Wikipedia, and then I couldn't find this work published, but I found this short, you know, piece of text by some researcher, and I started reading it, and it made sense, and I want to read it once again here, just a few paragraphs. Since it's written after, like, it's not Bertrand Russell from 100 years ago, it's kind of recent. And it, once again, it makes a lot of sense. In the past decade, popular and social scientific journals have abundant with discussion of leisure. Articles have appeared on mass leisure, labor and leisure, the new leisure and on leisure time, trips, clothing, rooms, and equipment. More recently, the imminent possibility of a shorter work week has stimulated a new rush of articles on the same general topics. Sebastian de Grazia's book strikes a sharp contrast with most of the existing literature, for he says flatly that there is no leisure in America. Never has been, under present political and economic conditions, probably will never be. Most of the talk, he says, is about free time, the concept being no intrinsic relation to leisure. The bulk of his study is a well-executed polemic aimed at separate leisure and free time and are showing that neither is as rampant in our in this country as the barks of industrialization and democracy would have us believe. Like this expression, the barks of industrialization and democracy. And basically, all these ideologies. History of leisure, not worth the contribution of the work, is a delineation of the classic conception of leisure and its history in Western society. The author holds, with many others, that the idea of leisure was born in Greece and nurtured by the most eminent of Greek philosophers, especially Aristotle. In its pristine form, this idea had little to do with time. It referred rather to a state of being in which activity was performed for its own sake or as its own end. De Grazia feels that the cardinal elements of the philosopher's views are captured in his definition of leisure as the state of freedom from everyday necessity, whether this necessity be labor or some other form of contrasting constraining activity. As the golden age of Greece lost its shimmer, the ideal of leisure migrated to Rome and then passed on to the far reaches of Europe via the Christian monasteries. As the ideal moved westward, however, its elan became progressively weakened. The Romans identified too closely with play. The monks, bent upon carrying religion and culture to the frontiers of Europe, found that contemplation and leisure had to be sacrificed in the interest of manual labor. Then during the Middle Ages, men took and dominated nature through science, and the life of leisure became even harder to defend. With the advent of the Reformation, work acquired moral tone that it had not enjoyed before, and leisure came to be viewed as something less than virtuous. The lowest point in the history of the ideal, the author claims, is the present-day American society, where a striving toward leisure has been replaced by a quest for free time and the good life of consumption. De Grazia holds that the weakness of the leisure ideal in the United States is nowhere more evident than in the ease with which leisure has become identified with free time. In his chapter, Time Given and Time Taken Away, he laments the peculiar manner in which free time is accounted and proceeds to show that the much taught gains in time off the job since the last century can be explained by several statistical artifacts. It is almost a commonplace in writings on leisure to see a table purporting to show that the reduction of working hours in the 1980s has led to an increase of 30 or more hours per week of free time. The author takes this approach to task on the grounds that it bypasses many work-related limitations in time that were not present in the last century. Most notable among these are second job holding, moonlighting, increased transportation time and to and from work, an increase in do-it-yourself repair work, machine placement on the job, and majority in migratory mobility. Migratory. Through the use of some rather gross calculations, Grazia attempts to show that the gains deriving from a reduction in working hours are almost completely offset by the factors listed above. Can you read the whole thing, the whole idea? Like, if just a remark from me from the future. So it's a nice book, probably deserves to be read. But you know, if I would like to get deeper into the study of the concept, I'll probably find this book and read it, since it may be interesting. I mean, it sounds so. In this contradiction or opposition between the idea of free time and leisure. That is basically a place one thing, presents one thing and as the other, and actually the values, the concept of leisure is this idea, I think. I understand that, just I didn't think, no, usually when you read some summaries, yeah, if it's a great writer, if you want to understand it better, it probably makes sense to read the whole book, like 200, 300 pages. But yeah, I guess like just to read the book because I want to understand the style of this DeGrasse and how he argues, and you know, just to enrich my vocabulary or understanding, maybe makes very little sense. But anyway, yeah, once again, on time, work, and leisure. So another book, this is a Schopenhauer book, Essay on Living Wisdom, or what's the name of the book? The Essays of, yeah, the Wisdom of Life. And I basically checked just the word leisure, and as you may see, there's like at a certain section of the book, there is lots of going on about leisure. I've read almost every sentence where the word was mentioned, and I now want to do it once again. So it's like Schopenhauer view. Like the first time when I was reading Schopenhauer, I remember this idea of leisure. In Russian, it's called dasuk, and in Latin, it's called otium. It made a great impression on me, and yes, exactly. Now I can see it clearly. So I read this book in August of 2012, and my essay, which I showed before, this reflection on work, which I published on Prozero, they were written at the September of 2012. So I wrote this article after reading Schopenhauer. And that's so fun. I mean, yeah, I basically probably work like, and there's an article, of course, I included at the last paragraph, is basically a long quote from Schopenhauer. Now I'm coming back to him, and I just want to see what he is going to say. He's much more harsh than Bertrand Russell. I mean, he doesn't care about being polite and, you know, being. He doesn't care about his readers in terms of like he is not afraid of saying what he thinks, and not just what he, but he's not afraid of exaggerating and, you know, making other people feel upset, especially those whom he writes about. The wise man will, above all, strive after freedom from pain and annoyance, quiet and leisure, consequently a tranquil, modest life with as few encounters as may be. And so after a little experience of his so-called fellow man, he will elect to live in retirement, or even if he is a man of great intellect, in solitude. Yeah, that's not just about leisure, it's also about solitude. Yeah, so the whole idea is that don't talk to people, don't communicate with people, don't spend your time, go and study philosophy. That makes sense. Communications lead to nowhere most of the time. Okay, again, I'm just interpreting what's written here. I, of course, may have different opinions, and I'm not going to share it right now. Or if I will share, well, I'll say this is my opinion. That's how I think. The brain may be regarded as a kind of parasite of the organism. A pensioner, as it were, who dwells with the body. And leisure, that is, the time of one has for the free enjoyment of one's consciousness or individuality, is the fruit or produce of the rest of existence, which is in general only labor and effort. Okay, the brain regarded as a kind of parasite of the organism, and the leisure, the fruit or produce of the rest of existence, which is in general only labor and effort. It's like he basically compares the brain, the brain and body, or intelligence and will, if we use his terms, other terms, is the same as leisure and work. So basically, all what's going on here, like it's hard labor, like everybody suffers to get food, you know, to survive. And leisure, it's when you succeeded and you found something for a certain period of time to provide with your basic needs, and you may just do whatever you want to, again, to pursue, to have all sorts of pursuits. And the brain is also like, brain always works for body, but as soon as you fulfill your basic needs, as soon as you don't need to work anymore, you may just, you know, develop some kind of intellectual curiosity, and your life may be like what I'm doing right now. So you may just read books, talk about them, study literature, poetry, philosophy, practice all sorts of arts, writing, thinking, music, whatever you like. And yeah, have lots of pleasure from doing that. Anyway, let's go on. Oh yeah, and there's like, this was actually the sentence which I want. Like, now he's going to attack. He's going to attack whom? I don't know. But what does most people's leisure yield? Boredom and dullness. Except of course when it's occupied with sensual pleasure or folly. So what do you want to say here? I like the sentence. I mean, let me just take the whole sentence and put it in my list to discuss it later at the speaking club. The whole idea is brain and body, right? So when brain is free, or let's use terms like intelligence and will. So your will is basically, you can't satisfy it. You can't find the place. Like, as long as you're alive, you always want something. And your brain is basically the servant of your wants, of your wills. And your brain just goes and, do all sorts of, doesn't go, of course, anywhere, but, you know, just a figure of speech. So your brain basically performs all work for your body. So imagine, like, there's a family, there's a husband, and there's a wife. And the wife is, like, this lady of leisure. And and the husband is just a hard-working man. And so this is like family, it's like one organism. And the body, the will is the wife, and whatever she wants, husband runs and work and brings money, and she spends money as she wants to spend them. And the husband is like a brain, like figures out what to do, like how to get money, how to get some things. And so the whole idea here is that, most of the time when wife doesn't want anything, brain doesn't want, like, the husband has no idea what to do. And he basically just engages in some stupid activities. So just drinks, or he may watch TV and, read some stupid newspapers, or, play video games, whatever. And so he needs always will to be like his wife, to tell him, like, go to work and bring money. And wife, of course, will spend money somehow. Husband is like my comparison. I'm just trying to illustrate the point of Schopenhauer. So his point is like intelligence and will. And for most people, like, as soon as they discover leisure, what he was about. But what does most people leisure yield? Most people's leisure yield boredom and dullness, except of course when it is occupied with sensual pleasure and folly. So it's like, for an average man, what he wants to say, for an average man in society, and for an average brain as well, as soon as there's no any need, the brain just crashes and doesn't do any meaningful work. It's a problem for, like, Schopenhauer doesn't like it. He wants everybody to study philosophy and do some meaningful things, and except of just wasting their time and doing some useless things, which are, again, like, useless from his point, from my point, from somebody else's point. But there's, you just develop certain stupid habits from your childhood, to drink, to play cards, to get around with people who just, makes no, who just do nothing. Anyway, let's go on. There's another continuum. How little such leisure is worth may be seen in the way in which it is spent. And as Ariosto observes, how miserable are the idle hours of ignorant men. Ordinary people think merely how to how they shall spend their time. Man of any talent tries to use it. The reason why people of limited intellect are apt to be bored is that their intellect is absolutely nothing more than the means by which the motive power of the will is put into force. Whenever there is nothing particular to set the will in motion, it rests and their intellect takes a holiday, because equally with the will, it requires something external to bring it into play. Well, I don't want to comment on that. Examples of what I meant are of daily occurrence and mentioned to our life, since then leisure is the flower or rather the fruit of existence, as it puts a man into possession of himself. Those are happier indeed who possess something real in themselves. But okay, it's like there were some other sentences which I want to find. Okay, phrase of leisure, independence. Yeah, this idea of undisturbed leisure. Of course, the characteristic of the intellectual man implies that he has one more need than the others. The need of reading, observing, studying, meditating, practicing. The need, in short, of undisturbed leisure. For as Voltaire has very rightly said, there is no real pleasures without real needs. And the need of them is why to such a man pleasures are accessible, which are denied to others. The varied beauties of nature and art and literature. All right, what else? One more comparison, intellect and will. So mere leisure, that is to say intellect unoccupied in the service of the will, is not of itself sufficient. There must be a real superiority of power set free from the service of the will and devoted to that of the intellect. For as Seneca says, otium is leisure, rather. Otium sine literis mors est et vivia homines sepultura, which means like leisure without reading is burning oneself alive. Yeah, and from this conception, the literate leisure is a form of death, a living tomb. Yeah, I remember I was memorizing this sentence when I was studying life in 2013. Hence, understood the occupation for himself, his own thoughts and works is a matter of urgent necessity to such a man, so it is welcome, leisure is the highest good. And everything else is unnecessary, nay, even burdensome. Yeah, the whole idea of intelligence, like Schopenhauer will repeat itself later. Like, I don't need to go on here. I may just say what I think about it. So the whole idea of intelligence is that not most of the time, but there is an idea that people have to develop their intelligence for a certain purpose. And smartness, which is like smartness, now is perceived as the practical tool for achieving some stupid goals. Like, for if you have a good car, and if you are rich, you are smart. If you are poor, you are not smart, and you may be like genius, but nobody gives a fuck, since you just have nothing, have no material possessions. And the whole idea, according to Schopenhauer, your intellect is the base, if you develop your intellect, there is no need to have any purpose for doing that. You don't need to serve your will. You don't need to serve any desires. So the whole idea is that developing intellect is the goal in itself. So reading, developing your language, developing your personality, studying philosophy, writing poetry, studying all sorts of sciences, engaging all sorts of arts, but doing it well, it's another idea. Yeah, it's all about, it's all goal in itself. French famous saying, art for art, the art for the art's sake. Yeah, and it was severely criticized by socialists and by communists. I remember I was reading Pisa, like there's an opposite view. So basically, whole idea of the social democrats, starting from like Russian social democrats, starting from Belinsky, then the Berlin with Pisarev, whatever, Chernyshevsky, Lenin, all their ideas is just, we have to work. And they basically developed this idea, like work, work, work is virtue, and labor is virtue. And Marxist is like all about like work, hard work. And there's like an opposite view. And you know, when you, the truth is that when you truly learn about both views, you see that they're certainly incompatible, because you know, if you put like Pisser, for example, on Schopenhauer and make them discuss what should be done in society, and you know, make them talk about leisure, they certainly will not just disagree, just kill each other in like a few hours. I mean, not kill, but you know, they will argue with each other. But when you just like when you read both, you see that I completely agree with Schopenhauer. But when I read Pisser, I agree with Pisser. And you know, he makes me believe that this is true. And it's very hard to reconcile. I mean, you may have both ideas. The only thing is like, you know, you may just think about it in a way that the intellect, like, it's not a goal in itself, it's a goal for, you know, it creates some kind of better, some kind of project. You may think about yourself as an educator. For example, if you develop your intellect, you basically, what do you do? You basically do some intellectual work. And if nobody gives a fuck, it doesn't matter. You just continue doing that and develop it, and probably it will have impact later in the future. And if not, who cares? Like, you still, it makes sense. You have to understand, it makes sense for you if you develop your intelligence. You don't need to serve your will. You don't need to serve your desires, or, you know, you don't need to seek for comfort. There's enough comfort just having a few meals a day and living in a just, you know, in a small room, having the internet and, you know, books, libraries. That's all. Nature, you go whenever you want. Okay, Schopenhauer, yeah, I like this contradiction, will, whatever, intelligence. I also had this, I guess now I'm going to shoot the next page. This is a video by Timothy Kerswell. I don't know who, like, I watched only this lecture yesterday, the whole lecture, and it's about Veblen's theory of leisure class. And I even wanted to read the book, like the theory of the leisure class, first in Veblen, since I discovered him the first day when I started studying the concept of leisure, and I was going to read, but I didn't read anything, since it's like 400 pages, and I definitely have no time for reading 400 pages. But his ideas, yeah, I'd like to read at least the preface. But I probably wouldn't do it here, since I'm talking for 3 hours. I'll do it later, but I need to have a break, probably go for a walk. But I want to say that I watched this guy, Thorsten Veblen, for an hour, his lecture, and he explains everything quite clearly. So to understand the ideas of Thorsten Veblen, it's unnecessary to, well, if you want to go deeper, of course, it's necessary to read the whole book, but to watch just one lecture, 1 hour of his summary and his explanation, it makes a lot of sense. And there's conspicuous consumption, conspicuous leisure, and basically his ideas and ideas of presenting in Becha and Russell book are kind of, you know, not similar, but you know, they argue about different things. So this guy, Thorsten Veblen, he's basically a pessimist, and he sees that there's no way. He basically describes what's going on. He says there's this leisure class, and it basically oppresses the whole body of society, and there's prestige, and people just care about, you know, buy some stupid thing, buy some useless things, like, you know, luxury, jewelry, whatever, and they rise in price, and they have no utility, but still people buy them because they want to compete in this status game. They want to win, they want to perceive themselves as more important than it. Like, basically we spend lots of our human potential on completely useless things. But you know what is useless? Of course, in art, we may also say like art, intellectual pursuits are also maybe useless completely. Nobody cares about them. And if people like to do that, why not? Well, why not? Because there are some other people who suffer, but it's in the same way. You may say, you shouldn't be a philosopher, you shouldn't like me. You may tell me, or I may tell you, if you're a philosopher and writing books and developing yourself, you know, trying to become like some kind of genius, studying 50 languages, I may tell you, no, you shouldn't do that. You should like, study one language or two languages and go and teach other people. That's the problem, since other people are stupid. And you're, you know, trying to become the smartest guy in the world. I consider that going to teach other people. That's what you need to do. If you're a philosopher, you don't need to grow, like you don't need to become some Shakespeare, you don't need to become somebody like, you know, Einstein. It's unnecessary. What's necessary is to go and teach stupid kids or, you know, some stupid people and give them a certain amount of knowledge which you already have. And the same like with rich people. So people who want to become rich and who want to become like the richest people, that you may say, oh, they have like hundreds of billions, and it's unnecessary. You don't need so much money. Just give this money to other people. No, it's like for them, they may have the same argument. They may say, why not? It's like, it's what I want to do. This helps me. And my money is like I create jobs, I engage other people in work, I pay some, you know, wages, and I actually create, I'm not a narcissistic or whatever, like psychopathic. Whoever, I'm just a very decent person, and what I'm doing is really important. So everybody may justify themselves. Okay, this Thorstein Veblen basically he criticizes the rich for creating this leisure class and the world creating this unnecessary like useless things. I just watch the video by yourself. Yeah, and if you want to go deeper, read the book. I'm not going to read the book since, as I said, I don't have time now. And it's there. The place of final thought. I just checked this. So that's all for today. I mean, I'm going to read the preface later, and maybe tomorrow, if I have time, I'll record one more video on leisure. I'm sure that there would be some interesting information on this preface, and probably I'll read a few chapters or beginning of these chapters, find some new vocabulary for understanding this concept. Maybe say something more about shopping hours since I just stopped here. But yeah, it was fun. I mean, today it was the most exciting day. And I guess I have just a few minutes to finish. Today I spent, I guess, 3 or more hours recording the video. Yeah, I'm thinking about making more videos like that. So I don't care about length. I'm going to make 3-4 hours videos every day. And I'm doing them for myself. So basically, it's the way how I study. So if you want to study, if you want to develop your language, you don't need to listen to me and to listen to everything what I say or read books which I read. Just you may apply the same method. So what you are doing, you just find something that you are interested in, any concept, and study it in the same way. Just talking, thinking aloud, like reading books, thinking aloud, recording yourself, publishing on the internet. Even if you are going to say some stupid, silly things, like, who cares? This is the tool. This is how you may use it. This is how you may develop your personality, develop your intelligence, how you may become a philosopher or writer or whoever you want to be. Just by finding something that you have some intellectual curiosity about, starting talking about, recording videos, publishing them, even if you say stupid things. Once again, go and watch videos which I published 4 years ago in English. Just nonsense. And still, it's like to get there where I'm right now, to reach this understanding, it requires this work. So it's inevitable. If you will just read books and think and write nothing and don't speak about it, you won't be able to get to the level which you may reach by putting your thoughts in words. So by talking about it, and especially if you record videos, it's also, it may sound strange, it may sound stupid. Who cares? This is an amazing method. And I'm just giving you an example. Probably you won't be able to see this video like the next 10, 15, 20, 50 years. Since nobody interested in this stuff nowadays. Very few people. Those who are interested, they do the same stuff by themselves. But if I succeed in the future, and look, I'm doing it, you may watch like the thousands of videos I already published. And I'm doing videos like every day like that. My goal is not to make like to capture your attention by making some videos where, you know, there's distractions everywhere and you watch something and you think it's smart. And then after a few minutes, you watch another video and you forget about the previous one. My goal here is to show you how you can study seriously something that you want to study. And I'm an expert in learning. So what I'm doing for the last like 12 years, I'm basically not learning anything in particular. Even though I may say I'm studying philosophy, psychology, science, myself, whatever, the world, poetry. I'm like studying how, I'm learning how to learn. And I encounter different methods. I'm trying to apply these methods for my study. I'm trying to, you know, understand what's really going on, not to get kind of, you know, to remember something and then think that I know something. It's not the purpose at all. So it's like, there's essence, there's an appearance. I don't want to appear as a smart person by memorizing. I may memorize like hours of talk. So if I want, you may watch my video, my lecture on how to think in English. It's in Russian, but this whole lecture, it's like 20 minutes of this lecture I memorized. 20 minutes of this lecture. The first 20 minutes, it's a speech. Like you won't be able to identify and say that I'm like, memorize it since I prepared it so well that it's indistinguishable from natural speech. And I wrote the speech like there were 10 pages, then I memorized them, then I rehearsed them like 50 times. And then I came and gave this lecture. And then we basically memorize everything. I have enough time to memorize books. So I might take like some books, like, you know, books which are like Carlos Castaneda, for example, Journey to Islam. If I really want, of course I have lots of other things to do and I don't want to do that right now, but if I really want, let's suppose there's a need, like if I don't do it in next year, let's suppose there's like some there's gun to my head and I tell myself that if I don't do it at the end of this year, I'll die. So the whole idea, I'll be able to memorize the whole book. Or you know, memorize few hours of speech and then pretend that I'm just speaking naturally and that it's all just improvisation. Whereas in reality, I just memorized everything. I may create lectures, like 20-minute lectures, great videos, summarizing all philosophers whom I read. Like, you know, if I start talking about Kant or Hegel or Nietzsche or Schopenhauer, I may basically just sit here. I already read like not all, but 10 volumes of Hegel, for example. I may just read Hegel all the time for months and talk about him like that. And I know that I may just like record lectures as, you know, some people, like YouTube philosophers, like Gregory Sadler, whatever, records and create some channel where there will be 20 videos and there's like great videos and I may just gain popularity and attract the audience by placing everywhere my videos and saying, no, look how good I am, how well I understand philosophy and all this crap. And by that, just, you know, accomplishing, like it's one small project, I may do that, accomplish that in, not probably in English, maybe in my native language, since my English is not sufficient for that purpose. But I may do that, and then it's relatively simple, but it's not the purpose. The purpose is to do what I'm doing right now, but to do it as well as I could do it in English, as I could do it in Russian. I mean, I want to develop my language to the level where I may just start reading Schopenhauer or Nietzsche or Kant or Hegel and just tell you, understand their ideas and them way deeper than anybody else can understand. And it's not the goal, again, to provide you with some information. It's just something that I really like to do. I'm passionate about it. I like to do that. And if you, like, I'm not doing it for you or for the sake of humanity or for somebody else. I'm doing it just because I really like to do it. But I see that I can do it well. And if you have the same, you know, passion or, you know, if you're passionate about language, if you want to develop your, you know, ideas, if you want to become a philosopher, it's a waste of time for you to watch me. So you have to do it on your own. You may watch me like 10, 15, 20, 100 hours. And especially if you are just watching this video in 21 you know, 50 or whatever, like in 2050, for example, or in 2070 when I'm already gone. So you may watch it, but it's basically it's going to be a waste of time. You, what you need to do is just original works by original writers and your own actions. So you do whatever I'm doing here. You start talking, start explaining how you understand something. Start rephrasing it, not just rephrasing it, but no, making sense of it. So that now, for example, I had this experience of talking to the camera for, like, I don't know how many, eight hours, let's say. During this week, I have been talking to the camera for 8 hours or 9 hours. And this is my experience. So whenever now I want to go deeper in this experience, I always have an access to it. If I want to understand the concept of leisure, I may just remember what I was doing. And for me, again, I may talk about tennis and understand it even deeper. So I may read other books and I'll remember them just because I spent these 8 hours by talking, by verbalizing my thoughts, by trying to understand what I'm reading, trying to understand why I'm reading that, trying to somehow connect it with my personal experience. Yeah, and once again, I'm going to do it in the future. Yeah, the only thing which stops me now from real growth, like, I'm doing real growth, but you know, there's some stupid wishes. I want to do it better, and there's no way to stop this wish. I mean, I know that it's something that makes me look a little bit stupid when I just talk that I need to speak better and I need to understand something better. Whereas I may just enjoy what I'm doing and just continue doing that without being upset about the quality of my performance. But it seems like this kind of intuitive urge, I can't stop it. But it's like it's only on the surface, since inside I'm calm and I don't care too much about it. Like, I know that it's all determined and there's no way like, for me doing anything else. And so what was there? I wanted like, to finish it by some, you know, to say something smart. But probably everything smart I already said. Yeah, the whole idea of the internet, it's incredible. I mean, man, this opportunity, it's unbelievable. I mean, I can do that. Like what I've done today for 3 hours, I mean, that it takes me no effort. So it's some intellectual effort, but I don't feel like really overwhelmed. I mean, I'm going to do it every day for 3 hours. And where can I end up? Like in a year, if I do it like every day for 3 hours, especially if I set some goals like avoiding all pillars and practicing pronunciation, learning how to speak clearly and explain everything in a way that is not only relevant for me, for myself, but for other people. So if I'm able to engage in kind of productive conversations with people on the internet with artificial intelligence. Yeah, that's mind-blowing. That's so funny. All right, so let's finish here. If you like it, you know what to do. I'm not going to tell you anything. And the only thing is, which I would like to ask you, if you're a native speaker and you manage to watch the whole video, you may notice many, not mistakes, but, you know, I would say well, mistakes as well, but, you know, you may help me to correct my mistakes if you have leisure to do that. And if you see that that sometimes I use the same phrase or the same expression, which isn't appropriate, and I use it a lot, you may write me in comments and tell me. I often open to all sorts of criticism. You even call me a fool and explain why do you think I'm a fool and what I'm doing is stupid. Since, yeah, I prefer like praise. If you want to, like, I don't appreciate any praise. So if you want to say like how smart I am and how much I helped you, it's like it's irrelevant. For me, I will just I will dismiss it. It's not what I need. Like I need real, like if you watch it, if you want to help me, if I'm still alive and you still watch it, if you want to help me, criticism, welcome. Everything else, just you know, you may just of course express your whatever, but I don't need it. I need understanding. And I do it basically for myself, not for you. So whatever I've done to improve my language, to improve my understanding, to improve my, you know, consciousness. All right, that's all. See you next time.